Panthers, the most powerful offensive machine in the National Hockey League, have been pushed to the brink in the Stanley Cup Finals. Every game, it seems they get a lead, and yet half the time, it hasn't mattered. Again in Game 6 of the series at Philadelphia Spectrum, Edmonton's defenseman Kevin Lowe scores shorthanded, and again, the Oilers had an early lead. But you know, deficits just don't seem to bother the Philadelphia Flyers, at least not in this series. Mike Keenan's team has never scored the first goal in any game of this series, so even though they trailed the Oilers with less than 7 minutes to go last Thursday night, they kept the faith, and why not? That's when Philadelphia's Brian Propp, who's having his best playoff season ever, tied the game at two with his power play bullet from the slot. But Coach Mike Keenan and his team needed yet another miracle, yet another score to force a decisive seventh game tonight. And just over a minute after Propp scored, lightning struck again in the Spectrum.
On down to Zezel. They've got a 3-on-2. Zezel moves in, feeds for Propp nicely. Back checked away by Curry. Drive, Daniel.
Daniel, Maple Leafers are the players and fans again, and the message is clear in Philly, both to Lord Stanley and, yes, to Wayne Gretzky. Will the Oilers bail out of their tailspin and win the Stanley Cup tonight, or will Philadelphia pull off what seemed impossible only a week ago? ESPN, the network of the National Hockey League, presents the Edmonton Oilers and the Philadelphia Flyers. Tonight, live from the Northlands Coliseum in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, it's Game 7 of the Stanley Cup Finals, hockey's ultimate test. Wayne Gretzky, the best player the game has ever known, will be coming out flying tonight. You can be sure of that. And goaltender Ron Hextall of the Flyers will try to make sure that Gretzky doesn't land the puck in the Flyer net. Tonight, the Flyers and the Oilers go for hockey's holy grail, the Stanley Cup, live on ESPN.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Northlands Coliseum in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. It's time for Game 7, hockey's ultimate game, live on ESPN. We haven't had the finals of the Stanley Cup go to a decisive seventh game since 1971 in Chicago Stadium. On that night, Montreal beat Chicago 3-2. What will happen tonight? Well, for some pregame comments, let's go upstairs to the men who called tonight's action, Mike Emmerich and Bill Clement.
Tom, boy, we're glad you're with us tonight. We're charged up, maybe a little bit nervous, but Bill, take us into the locker room. What about the players?
I'm not sure I can, Mike. I won two championships, but they were in six games, so I'm not sure what's going on. It's pressure-filled. I can guarantee you that all of the players have pretty well played this game in their mind when they were little kids, but it was on the street playing road hockey. Pressure is the key word tonight, Mike, and I think the team that doesn't react or the team that has the smallest reaction to the pressure will probably win the game tonight.
Do you think any of these guys slept last night?
Oh, I imagine the number of them did, but I guarantee that there's at least a handful on both sides that had trouble sleeping last night.
17,500 inside, and they are paying as much as $1,000 per seat to scalpers from the outside, Tom.
Yes, and a lot of people wish they had the scratch to get inside here tonight. Let me tell you, a full house, they're going crazy. But down in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, at Kaminsky's Ale House, they're also going crazy, cheering for the orange and black of the Philadelphia Flyers. Our Mike Forrest is standing by live now. So let's go to Mike at Kaminsky's in Cherry Hill.
Thank you, Tom. We are in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. And as you can hear, we are with Flyer fans. The Flyers' practice rink is about 4 miles that way. We are Cherry Hill, but this is definitely Flyer country. These fans, unlike the fans at the Northlands Coliseum, who are notoriously quiet, as you can hear, are notoriously loud and very supportive of their team. This place is going to go crackers tonight, and we'll be checking back with you throughout the evening. Back to you, Tom.
Mike, there's not much to say except the Edmonton Oilers and the Philadelphia Flyers, hockey's two best teams, are about to play one game for the Stanley Cup. We needn't say anything more. Settle back and enjoy it tonight, live on ESPN. We'll be right back in a moment. Game 7 of the Stanley Cup Finals, live on ESPN, is being brought to you by Chrysler Plymouth. We're working together to be the best. And by the crisp, clean, imported taste of Labatt's Blue. It's blue heaven. I'm telling you, I have never heard this building so loud. Now, for more pregame ceremony, let's go upstairs again, high atop Northlands Coliseum. Mike Emmerich and Bill Clement will do that after we rejoin
address announcer for the national anthems of the United States and Canada.
First, the American national anthem, and then please join in and sing along with Canada's national anthem, Mr. Paul Lauriol.
Broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. For the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave growth through the night that flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Oh, Canada, our home and native land, through patriot love in all our sons of man, with glowing hearts we see thee rise a throne more strong and free. We stand on a guard for thee. God keep our land glorious and free. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee.
With the singing of the national anthems of the United States and Canada. The referee for tonight's game is Andy Van Helleman. The linesmen are John D'Amico and Ron Finn. The backup, Dave Newell and Bob Hodges. The off-ice officials are from Calgary.
And as we expected, the battle of the goalies will continue. Still waiting for a glitch. Somebody to falter. Ron Hextall hasn't yet. And you know, in the last couple of games, he has emerged from nowhere, as in most writers' minds, and they're the people that vote, as the leading candidate for the Smythe Trophy, as the most valuable player in the playoffs. It's going to be a hectic night for Ron Hextall. And at the other end, Grant Fuhr, who with a performance, a great performance tonight, also has to be considered as a leading candidate for the Smythe Trophy. Both exquisite series, exquisite playoffs.
A game played by grown men goes back to dreams from the basements and driveways and backyard rinks of childhood. In fantasy, it was always Game 7 for the Stanley Cup, and tonight it becomes a reality. The home team has a 6-2 record in the seventh game. Shel Samuelson and Brad Marsh, the defense pair for Philadelphia, and it's the prop line having the first opportunity denied by Fuhr. Puck trickled back for Muni, but Fuhr has to assert himself. Messier, Anderson, and Cheekin in the line for the Oilers as a shot on goal by Propp. Rebound pops in front, and it's scooped over for Messier. This is the line that has come up empty in the last three games. Glenn Anderson to Messier. Hit by Propp. Loose puck jammed by Nielsen and held by Hextall, and then the stick comes in from Mark Messier.
It came in all right. It came crashing down on Ron Hextall. All of the adrenaline pent up inside. And, you know, Mark Messier had an excellent opportunity to shoot there, Mike. We have heard a number of times that he is injured. We're not sure where. I saw him at one point. I looked through the door about two games ago and saw him with an ice pack on his wrist. That looked like a great chance for him to shoot, and he didn't. He ended up trying to deke his way in. Wasn't able to get there. Now he's drawn a couple of minutes in penalty.
Stick fouls are always enforced quickly.
There was his chance to shoot, and he didn't bother. He tried to get through both Brad Marsh and Brian Propp. Nielsen backhands. Watch Messier's cross-check. Right on the back of the head of Ron Hextall, and it will be a game of restraint tonight to see who can control their emotions the most, especially in the early going.
Philadelphia really showed some offensive flourish in the first 20 seconds.
Looking for a mistake. Marc Messier threw one out through his own mid-ice section in his own end, and it was gathered up by one of the Flyers, Brian Propp, who had a decent shot. We'll watch for mistakes early. There's almost uncontrollable adrenaline at this stage of the game.
Philadelphia with a power play goal in each of the last three games. 5 for 23 on the series. Duck Crossman to Mark Howe. They'll be the point men once they get it set. It is Murray Craven along with Eklund and Brian Propp out. And this is Craven giving to Howe for a shot that was wide. Eklund waiting for Philadelphia. Pivots it off for Crossman. Tested by McTavish. Puck sent further by Howe to Craven. Gets away from the battling of Charlie Huddy. Murray Craven with Propp taken down in front. Gets back up to play. Propp nudges to Mark Howe. Looks for Crossman. Howe with a shot. Pad stop. The arm of Andy Van Helleman is up. And the Oilers will be two men short.
What a hole has been dug for the Edmonton Oilers. Paul Coffey broke his stick right in the middle of the shaft. There was a clean break. It didn't even splinter. He cross-checked Brian Propp in the back, and he might have weakened his stick on the cross-check. Yeah, there it goes. And that couldn't have broken his stick. He had to break it on the cross-check. And then he ends up grabbing. There he is, right lower right of your screen, hanging on to Brian Propp while Mark Howe got a shot away. Talk about a break early in the hockey game. Two men down. The first penalty, a minute and 21 seconds left. That was to Messier. So we're looking at a two-man advantage for the Philadelphia Flyers for a minute and 21 seconds.
Philadelphia has not had a 5-on-3 in the entire playoffs. The Oilers have seen two of these in the playoffs before. They have yielded once, as you see Glenn Sather. Kevin Lowe, Quebec-born player on this Edmonton Oilers team.
He has a chance here, Mike, too, to be very big. He's one of the premier shot blockers in all of hockey, and you can't measure the value of a great shot blocker when you're down two men. Everybody has to chip in, and at one time or another, be the goalie, too.
Curry, Lowe, and Muni, the iron three. They force the Flyers back. It'll be Howe and Crossman remaining with the Eklund, Craven, and Brian Propp combination. Game 7, Stanley Cup Finals, three games apiece. Philadelphia has won five of its last six games by one goal. They've been the come-from-behind kids all the way in the Montreal series and in this one. It is Eklund looking, dishes off. Craven, a shot, he scores! And Philadelphia, for the first time in the series, gets on the board first.
And for only the second time in the series, they score a goal in the first period. They have it pretty well in control. Eklund will move it into Craven, and Craven will simply spin around and take a sharp angle shot that you have to believe surprised Grant Fuhr. You've got to figure that he's looking for the pass. This is not a high percentage place to shoot from. Right in off the skate plate, perhaps, off the right leg. Huge goal.
And still, a minute and 32 seconds to go on what is now a 5-on-4 power play. Lowe throws one out of play at the Oilers bench. Messier a cross check at 34 seconds. Coffey a hold at 113. And 18 seconds after that, the first goal of the game.
You know, Mike, the Flyers being here, it's a dream for them. And it's a dream for Murray Craven as he spins around and scores. But for the Oilers, it's a dream, but it's also a potential nightmare. Remember, these were the guys that were leading 3-1. And I have a feeling now that on their bench, a problem now is fighting away the nightmare. They're sitting there saying, the nightmare is happening. We've gone down two men, now we're down a goal. Is it going to get worse? They have to shore it up right now, psychologically. Big test for them. Can't get further behind.
You know, the joke on the street, Bill, has been Maybe the Oilers should let Philadelphia get ahead and see how they handle that, but that certainly can't be the joke at the bench.
It's not that far-fetched an idea to try. The Oilers, I think, should they take a lead, especially in the third period, would tend to be plagued by the nightmare of what happened in games 5 and 6. I don't think that's that bad a thought. Intentionally, they don't want to do it, but if it happens, I don't think they'll be very badly off, really.
Puck turned out of play. You wonder if there's any more adrenaline left at the well for these guys in orange,
don't you? And that is something that a coach can only hope doesn't happen, and that is leaving the energy behind. Your palms sweat, the adrenaline is flowing, you have trouble sleeping, and very often it's possible for the player to arrive at the game and be pretty well drained, and it won't show itself until you get to the halfway point, get down towards the third period. Sometimes you leave the energy up in the hotel room or at home if you're one of the Oilers.
1:05 to go on the 5-1-4 power play to Philadelphia, and Kevin Lowe forces the Flyers deep. Crossman takes, boomed right off by Messier, and he turned around and glanced back as it is Mark Howe playing it back ahead for Eklund, checked by Muni, but ahead now Brian Propp. Dumps, attacked by Gretzky, followed up by Crossman. Doug Crossman steps by Gretzky, lays it behind. Pass is turned to the point. Eklund there. Caroms one to Crossman. Crossman finesses. Tries to get behind. Pucked away by Fjord. Wonderful play by the Oilers goalkeeper.
Well, he's not that rattled, is he? Kevin Lowe went down to block the shot. We talked about a shot blocking. Crossman made a great play. He held it. Then Fjord had to come out. Fjord was the last guy, but he did it.
Uncharacteristically, Fjord gave Crossman a jab with the stick as Sutter tries for the top left and fails. 15 seconds to go, power play. 1-0 Philadelphia ahead on a 5-on-3 power play goal. We're early in the first period. Just over 3 minutes have gone off the big scoreboard clock. 17-5-02. That means 384 fans are standing here tonight at the Northlands Coliseum. Ron Sutter twirls back, and with that, penalty time is up. The teams are back even now. Samuelson playing for Sutter, who chipped one off Randy Gregg. Moving forward is Charlie Huddy. Avoids the check of Derek Smith and lays it around to Marty McSorley. McSorley headmans to McTavish. Crossing with Dave Hunter. McTavish wedged by Samuelson, and the puck loose for the big defenseman, Shel Samuelson. That one hit off Derek Smith and is chased down by Rayo Ruotsalainen. Ruotsalainen has come up empty in the entire series for the Oilers. No goals, no assists. Maybe he can change it now with a drive that's blocked off by Hextall. McCrimmon throws it around, but Dave Hunter is there. Here's Hunter with a shot. Save. Hextall doesn't see it. It's picked up by Brad Marsh. Around it is wrapped. Sinisalo can't play, but on with it is Craven. Outlet pass over to Derek Smith. He's tied up by McSorley and then carried to the boards in glass.
Mike, we know it's the Flyers' defensive play that really got them this far and gave them the great season they had. What a great example of it. Brad Marsh and McCrimmon were both there when Hextall needed them.
And there'll be a penalty coming up to Philadelphia. Gretzky has drawn an infraction. A Flyer to the penalty box. First power play coming up for the Oilers. They trail 1-0.
There's a look at Dave Poulin, who's off for tripping here. 15:38 to go in the first period. The Flyers leading by one. Here comes Wayne Gretzky. You know that he'll be in the center of all kinds of attention by the Philadelphia Flyers, and that time Poulin just got the stick on him. Here's a good overhead look at the save Hextall made, and he loses it. He goes to the right. Oh, what a great play by McCrimmon, hooking Curry out of the way. Yari Curry was right there. There's McTavish trying to get Brad Marsh, but the defenseman prevailed.
Bruce Omiski with Yari Curry and Wayne Gretzky. It'll be Gregg and Ruotsalainen in the point men. After that faceoff, Peter Zezel came to the bench. So it is Ron Sutter and Propp penalty killing for Philadelphia, and back Samuelson and Brad Marsh. 15:20 left. First period, Philadelphia ahead, 1-0. Power play to the Oilers. They try for Bruce Omiski. It bounces to Gregg, and Gregg's shot is blocked away by Hextall. Gregg behind. Gretzky feeds. Back out it comes to Curry. Yari Curry with a look, slow pass to Ruotsalainen, and that caused a problem. Nearly picked off by Propp, then drilled down by Samuelson.
No, that's the kind of slow pass that will come back to haunt you forever. That came about 6 inches from being a breakaway for the Flyers. He's got to snap him faster than that.
On comes Curry. Pass went right into Craven and is cleared back down by Zezel. 5 shots Oilers, 4 shots Philadelphia. Craven, the forechecker, exhibiting away is Steve Smith. Hands on to Curry, then ahead to Wayne Gretzky. Spins it off, but it's from the heel of the skate of Messier to be sent further by Craven. Smith drops it back to Gretzky. Anderson is now on the ice for the Oiler power play, which has 50 seconds to go. Messier, Anderson, in some traffic problem, hands over to Smith. Well, you've often said we should watch for nervous mistakes, especially early in a crucial game. We've seen a couple already. Anderson turns it loose again, and the Oilers have not crossed the red line since they made the shift change. Now it is Anderson. Well stop on the play by Acton. Tries to dump it further and get to the top of the drive. Answered by Fuhr. Glenn Anderson carries it back out. 15 seconds to go on the power play as he connects with Messier. Moves in, surrounded by Flyers, but beats one over to Charlie Huddy. Huddy and Gretzky, and it's fed back out to Lowe. Lowe plays it over to Anderson. Gets it back again. Angles one for Gretzky. Spins for Anderson. Tipped away. You saw the Flyers converge. Both with sticks outstretched. And it's Tocchet advancing it now to Eklund. Penalty time is up. They feed for Tocchet on the wing. Checked off by Anderson. And Anderson, with some help along the way from Charlie Huddy, can step free. 13:25 to go first period. Penalty box empty. Shot even at five. Flyers ahead 1-0. McTavish is out, and that went off Crossman. Moving in is McSorley. Behind, though, it is Daniel. And Dave Poulin, the captain of the Flyers, moving on this one. It is checked loose by McTavish, though Gretzky can't make a play. Daniel blocked. Then it's checked by McSorley as Doug Crossman feeds for Sinisalo, but it skitters all the way back down. And the puck sent from the defensive side of the center red line over the opposition. End line and touch by a member of that team. First icing stops the clock. With the score, the Flyers 1, the Oilers nothing.
Some pretty stable penalty killing by the Flyers. Rick Tocchet down the wing with a big blast on Grant Fuhr. That was a piece from Kelly Eklund. That was a short-handed chance, but that tells you what the Flyers are doing. They are on top of their game.
Here is Sinisalo starting out with Poulin up the wing. Sinisalo feeds for Poulin, but it's powered on defense by Muni. Quickly connects with McSorley, then through now to Dave Hunter. Hunter with a quick wrist shot grabbed by Hextall. And Hextall sweeps it back along to Sinisalo. Cross-ice passes to Poulin. Has Craven moving, and now we'll just loft the safety that goes over the back glass and will force a center ice faceoff. Bill, we played 7:25. What have you seen?
I've seen the Edmonton Oilers look very jittery, and I don't have trouble understanding why. Here's Hunter's shot, and Hextall snare as well. It's a pretty good save. It didn't look like it when he first made the shot. But you would have to expect that the pressure is on the Oilers. And Kent Nielsen told me this morning, we are going to shoot a lot more, especially me. Kent Nielsen's angry. That time it was Hunter that shot. But the Oilers are the ones that are under the gun. Remember, the parade was planned a few days ago for Game 5 in here. Everybody expected the Oilers to dispense with the Flyers. In Game 5, it didn't happen. Game 6, it didn't happen. They're the ones that are under the gun. So it's no wonder to me that they look jittery. And it shows itself to me, their big guns are making poor passes. Seen Wayne Gretzky try some low percentage passes, Messier, Anderson. They haven't clicked on any of their passing. That's one of this team's greatest skills.
Puck round around, and it's Carson dropping it back. Messier to take over. Kent Nielsen, the man that Bill just mentioned, is out now with Messier and Anderson, and this is Anderson getting by one. Feeds up the wing for Nielsen across to Messier.
Nielsen, he's going to appear to the left. There he is, breaking by Dave Brown. The feed to Messier, and it's not a good pass. He jams him, but Mark Messier is able to still direct it into the net. One of the most skilled lines in the world, the fastest skating line in the world by most people's reckoning. Messier, Anderson, Nielsen have tied it. There's the scorer right there.
Anderson and Nielsen the assist. Messier's first goal of this series. So this one is now stalemated at one. Moving in is Tikkanen. Shot from him, though, by Sanderson. Tikkanen followed through on a thumping check. Moves to this one. And gives it back to Curry. Slams one. Save Hextall. Rebound collared by Gretzky. Feeds it back. Ruotsalainen. Shot. Save Hextall. Covers. Stoppage of play. Thundering ovation. 17,500. Many of them standing. Game tied at one.
have a pretty good view from where we sit up here, and this isn't the exact location, but it's close. Nice overhead of the pass from Nilsson, and from up here, as soon as Nilsson got it, we all agree we're sitting here. Stage manager, statistician, Mike Emmerich, myself, we all knew that Kent Nilsson would see Mark Messier on that play. He sees the big play.
Ruotsalainen off Mark with the shot. Marsh rolls back down. And Grant Fuhr will tend. Oilers have gotten the last four shots in the game. One of them has gone in. It is tied at one. Glad you've joined us tonight on ESPN with Tom Meese and Bill Clement. Mike Emmerich from the Northlands Coliseum. Down goes Kekkonen. The arm of Andy Van Halen remains down, and that prompts some booing and also thoughtless throwing of debris. This is Hextall moving back out to play it. Swings it around, and Gretzky leaps but can't come up with it.
Great play by Hextall. He knows Gretzky's there. What does he do? He just goes over him. He shot that thing 10 feet into the air.
Play is to Gretzky. Loses to Eklund. Chips one that is handled by Samuelson. And Samuelson nicely away from Kekkonen. Big drive, and that blocked by Fuhr and then cleared back out. Pocket to play for Philadelphia. Rolls it back in, but it's Craig Muni on defense. With 10:50 to go in the first period. Gretzky moves ahead, but Howe denies him. Not once, but twice. Hunter rams into Howe, and the play comes back to Philadelphia. On with it is Eklund. Feeds it across. Props with a shot. Blocked it loose in front. Pushed away by McCurley. Out of the crease. Turnarounder. And it came to McCrimmon. Feeds one in front that's dumped away by Lowe. How close can it come? McTavish back in for the Oilers. Leaned on by the stick of McCrimmon, but he peels away. Greg McTavish still working for Edmonton. McCurley in to help out. Points it back to Lowe. Lowe cranks one. The pad and Hextall, and gathered in by Eklund. In a heap were Hextall and McTavish, but Lowe starts it back the other way again from center. Hextall goes charging out to play, but this is an offside call. And now Hextall and McCurley were locked for just a moment.
McCurley's in control tonight. He wouldn't mind drawing a penalty on Ron Hextall, and if he can just nudge him enough to get Hextall off his game and mad enough to take a penalty, he will have done a big service. Not as big as the one he paid to Grant Fuhr. Here's the shot by Propp, and we'll see McCurley come back in deep. Keep in mind, he's a forward. There are the two defensemen out of the play. Here comes Marty McCurley, and you know, defensemen and forwards are always kidding one another. They get back and forth sarcastically, position by position. Oh, yeah, it's the defense. You need help from us. And similar to defenses and offenses in football. But that time, the defenseman got the help from the forwards, and it was Marty McCurley that came all the way back in. Fuhr had absolutely no idea where it was.
Some of you longtime hockey fans will remember the names Schultz, Bladen, Flett, McLeish, Kelly, Kindrichuk, Jim Watson, Joe Watson. They're all here tonight.
They were brought here by Flyer President Jay Snyder. We're going to take a look at McTavish first. Bashing into Hextall. Boy, they're going to crowd tonight. It's going to be a long night for Hextall in that crease. Jay Snyder, along with his dad, Ed Snyder, the Flyers owner, brought all of those players that Mike mentioned here to Edmonton. To see if the current Flyers could draw from the tradition. And everybody got together last night and paid respects, everybody wishing one another luck.
Andy Van Helleman, the referee, 16th year of calling them. We may be seeing the last game tonight of John D'Amico as a linesman. His 23rd season, he's 49. Said, I'm going to give it some thought. Once the season's over, this could be his last. And what a career he's had. Even did some refereeing in the early days, but was a linesman back when the Flyers first won their championship in 74, even before that. On now, it is Kent Nielsen. Feeds it back for a shot, blocked off by Hextall, and then Anderson brushes into him, and Hextall just now getting back on all fours. Play made back up the wing. It's Mellenby for Philadelphia. Centers one off the skate. It went off Huddy and is punched away by Fuhr. Anderson tries to clear. Second effort, he'll be able to move it out to Messier. Has a man on the wing, Nielsen, and gets it to him. Nielsen wants to shoot. Now fires. Save, Hextall. Rebound, pumped loose. Hextall, Nielsen has got blocked by Hextall. Another one spun across. Charlie Huddy to play along to Messier. Tested there by Marsh. In comes Zezel, but it's kicked and not Samuelson's play to make. Wrapped around, Paul Coffey centers one, but it's Brad Marsh getting it on the Philadelphia defense and laying it back out. Is Hextall on it right now? Incredible.
9:08 to go. First period still tied at one.
Just another blast by Kent Nilsson. He said he was going to shoot. He's starting off wanting that puck and wanting to shoot every time he gets it. I almost thought that Brad Marsh might have made the save. We'll see about another look at it. Well, we're not going to see it. Hextall made one, and then Nilsson got it again. Great chances at both ends.
Rossman to Carson. Taken out by Curry on his Sutter. Able to control. Ron Sutter flipped it into Curry, but still battles for it. Punched it deep, and it is Tikkanen for Edmonton. Game tied at one. Messier his 12th of the playoffs. Craven his first. Craven came first, and that's a rarity in this series. As Philadelphia, up until tonight, had not gotten the first goal in any of these games. Best of seven Stanley Cup Finals. With Tom Meese and Bill Clement, Mike Emmerich from Northlands Coliseum, this is it. It doesn't go any further. This is the latest the NHL has ever played a Stanley Cup game. 31st of May. On now with it is Greg. Connects to Tikkanen. Back for Wayne Gretzky. With Greg in front. Backhander. Blocked away and then swept by Hextall. Tockett takes over. Greg. Jocelyn McDaniel, who has lost his stick. Meanwhile, back in comes Tockett to Ron Sutter. Deep slot. Can't get a pass away. Denied on that one by Muni. Wayne Gretzky slides it ahead. Dave Hunter moving in. Surrounded by Flyers. And they'll bring it back with Rick Tockett carrying. Muni moves out. Stewart has to help him make the play and then handcuffs him. Marty McSorley can't move it ahead. Eklund's forechecking pays off. It's Clark hanging behind. Centering one. And it's off pocket as he was wrapped up by McSorley. It is McCrimmon. Connecting on the turning wing to Rick Tockett, but that one a two-line pass stopping the clock. You want to know how tough it is in the pit. Get a look at Daniel.
Mike, this thing goes on and on to the point that the Flyers actually had a flurry down at the other end of the ice.
The score of the game, Philadelphia 1, Edmonton 1. Back to play, Brad McCrimmon with a pass that is tipped by Craven, gathered in by Muni. Onside, no, offside for McSorley. For those of you who just may be coming a part of this wonderful event of hockey tonight, we know that it's attracted attention of non-hockey fans as well. The puck must be the last thing, or rather the first thing across the last blue line, nearest the net at which you hope to score. If it's not, and one of your team is over, then the play is stopped and we have a center ice face-off to result. It can also happen on a pass, and that is what we've just seen.
And if you have been with us all the way, you're looking at a Craig McTavish who's changed his look. He doesn't have a beard. Day before yesterday, when the Oilers arrived back here in Edmonton, McTavish started it, and everyone with Glenn Anderson followed. About eight or nine of them had beards. They've all shaved, except Glenn Anderson.
Prop moves in. Hit by McTavish. Muni to play on the defense. Puck trickles. Pocket can't play. And it is Marty McSorley with 7:10 to go first period. Game tied at one. Down went McTavish. Oilers fans upset because there's no penalty. Hextall leaves for Howe. Howe, forced, shoves to Tockett. Pass too far for Prop. And so it's Huddy down, and Fuhr will not play to him. Instead, off the boards for McSorley, in stride. On with it, Paul Coffey. Quick shot is knocked down by Marsh. Follow-up by Messier, lost off his stick. Scramble in front. Nielsen poked at it, but it is underneath Ron Hextall, the goalkeeper.
Boy, the white wave looks as if it's building. And we have not seen Paul Coffey carry the puck with authority consistently throughout the playoffs, especially in this series. But boy, does he get it going here. Brad Marsh blocks the first one, but the key is Messier right behind him, who blazes right around Derek Smith for the rebound. Kent Nilsson's there for the rebound. They're a hungry bunch of Oilers. And that will create problems. Look at the traffic Hextall has. I mean, it's one thing to make the save when you're unscreened, but he is not even getting away with being untouched. They are running into him every chance they get. I guarantee you, though, they will not throw him off his game mentally. They might push him out of the way physically, but he's proven to me that he's as strong mentally as any pro athlete I've ever seen.
There you see Paul Coffey bearing down. Every man giving a Hextall a little nudge. This one goes through Coffey, and so the Oilers must regroup. Coffey and Huddy in back. That's the defense for the Oilers. And they have the Anderson, Messier, and Nielsen line up front. Puck flipped back over and followed up by Anderson. Watched by Marsh. Shot
turned away by Hextall. And it is Mark, followed up by Anderson. Follow through on his check. This is Messier. Hits the crossbar. No light is on. Play continues. The Oilers think they have one.
Well, they're playing their song. Andy Van Helleman was looking at the goal judge. He didn't put the light on. Van Helleman never blew it down. It didn't look from here as if it went in. Mike, did you see it as going in?
I thought it struck the crossbar.
Me too.
Here's Nielsen working on now to Mark Messier. 6 minutes left in the period. Messier tries to get through Samuelson, and Brad Marsh is there. On with it comes Brian Drop. This is a two-on-two with Ron Sutter. The drop is to him. Tries to finesse the defense, but pure air there to poke the puck along. Glenn Anderson for the Oilers. But this is Shel Samuelson for Philadelphia. Still buzzing a little bit at what they thought was a goal. Pekkanen moves in. Pestered by Eklund's checking. Puck handled by McCrimmon. Kept in nicely by the glove of Curry, but then lost in Eklund. Outlet for Philadelphia. On the wing to Propp. Big drive. Just popped calmly by Buehr. Rail Ruotsalainen, the one-time Ranger. Played in Europe early in the season. Came in the latter stages. Pekkanen's pass. Up the wing is off Curry. Hextall moves out. Chops it high. And along for Mark Howe. If this is the first look you're getting at Ron Hextall, he and Grant Fuhr are as different in style, especially when they handle the puck as day and night. Turning with this now is Mellenby, away from the checking of Gretzky. Mellenby trying to force it by Curry. Just the battle of feet along the board. It is Howe connecting on to Brad McCrimmon with 4:40 to go in the period. Flyers want a shift change, so they just drop in and get the shift completed with Daniel coming on now along with Crossman. Ahead for Edmonton is Hunter. Crosses and drops for Curry. Slam! And that's deflected wide. Could be Gretzky got a piece of it. Muni flips one in front. Glove down by Mellenby. Pestered by Hunter, who backhanded it wide. Crossman there. But it is given up to Kevin Lowe. Lowe flips, but into the glove hand of Crossman. Advances up the wing for Derek Smith. Smith fires one, and that one dropped by Fuhr. Swings it back along. Daniel pinching. Drives one off a skate. Loose pucks, and it's double a drive wide. Back up with it now comes Kent Nielsen. Two on two. Fires one off of Hextall. Curry along to play, but Sinisalo clears it out. Oilers must regroup so that they're not offside. Puck popped into the glove of Hextall. Poked away, but then Nielsen a drive, and Hextall just arrived in time. Sinisalo on now for Poulin. Dodges a check, loses the puck. McTavish back. Bumped off by Sinisalo. Loose puck to Dave Poulin. 3.5 to go. Tried for Sinisalo, but it's off his skate. Zezel, and then Poulin. And then Zezel moves to the front as Poulin slots to Crossman. Crossman a shot wide. Poulin, though staggered by a check, tried to play and punch it further and does. Peter Zezel, wrapped up by Coffey behind and wrestled off. In comes Poulin, but he can't get to it because of McTavish. Two aside, all the energy they've got battling for it. Puck to Crossman, saved yours!
Cross up, Mike. Two centermen out there, Messier and McTavish, and they couldn't make up their mind which one was a left winger, which one was a centerman. As a result, Crossman was open at least twice.
Here's Gretzky, pass tipped loose by Eklund. 1-1, 2:45 to go in the first period. Oh, this is great. Back on with it now comes Daniel. Drops it back in. Each time you see one of those nervous mistakes, it seems to be answered. Grant Fuhr that time blocked the shot of Crossman as Tockett flipped it back in. Randy Gregg turning for the Oiler defense. Beyond the reach of Propp and a chance for Gretzky to move away. Samuelson is back on defense. Gretzky lays it for Ruotsalainen, and because of the checking of Propp, he couldn't get a shot away. Randy Gregg now joined by Craig Muni on defense as the Oilers are in the midst of a shift change. Curry's pass goes to Shel Samuelson, but it's Gretzky working back on, though he misses for Pekkanen. In the final 2 minutes of period one, the goal scorers are Craven and Messier. Game tied at one, series tied at three. Your set. Craig Muni takes. Banks it off for Curry. Loses to Carson. Right of the net. A shot by Scott Mellenby was blocked away by Muni. And the puck tapped further by Gretzky. Ron Hextall cradling it. Throws it back for Ron Sutter. Shift change on for the Oilers. That's why Curry didn't make the play. He was coming to the bench. Back on now comes Messier. Messier drops to Anderson. Fights his way through. Shot one that was tipped wide. Taking it now is Huddy. Huddy tries to center. Blocked away by Hextall, and it's hopped wide. Turning with it is Scott Mellenby. Up the wing now for defenseman Brad McCrimmon. Moves in with Smith, and Grant Fuhr out to take over. A minute and 10 seconds to go in this opening period. The shots are 17-12, the Oilers. Penalties are three in number. All minors, two of those to Edmonton. Huddy wedged by Craven. And Murray Craven starts it ahead for Poulin. Nearly run off the play by McSorley. Gets it back again. While falling, plays wide.
Mike, we should have known that neither one of these goalies is going to fall. There's just a splendid play at both ends with quality chances. It'll be interesting to see the total quality shots. They both had excellent opportunities. Once again, it's the Grant Fuhr versus Ron Hextall battle.
The score of the game remains Flyers 1, Oilers 1.
Gretzky is satisfied that it wasn't a goal.
Brad Marsh rolls, roots a line and keeps. It is Yari Curry, but he gave it up to Marsh. The last half minute of this period. Marsh, stepped by Tiekkanen, loses control, though, and the puck dumped back near Shel Samuelson. Swedish-born defenseman angles one back in. Played back out by Greg to Gretzky. Has Tiekkanen moving with him. Gretzky fakes the big drive, then curls. That's his play. It's to Greg. Wide! As Hextall was down when the shot came through.
Everybody was down. Brad Marsh was down with his legs in the air. So was Hextall. I think Randy Gray just shot wide.
And the siren goes to end the first period. 18 shots for the Oilers, 12 for the Flyers. At the end of one, game tied at one.
Road to the Cup, the Stanley Cup Finals live on ESPN, being brought to you by Bud Light, the light beer with a first name and taste. Everything else is just delight. And by Volvo, a car you can believe in. Well, the Oilers and the Flyers are giving fans across North America a hockey game they can certainly believe in. We're 1-1 after one. Let's go back up now for the second period to Mike Emmerich and Bill Clement.
Thank you, Tom. Fans here are standing as their team is skating around prior to the start of the second period here. Murray Craven got the first goal of the game at 1:41, his third of the playoffs, second of the series on the power play from Eklund and Crossman. Then Mark Messier with his first goal of this series, 12th overall in the playoffs, Anderson and Nielsen assisting at 7:45. Shots 18-12, Oilers. Game knotted at one. Bill, you know, throughout this playoff, we've talked about the contrasting styles and who's able to lure who into playing their type of game. What's the answer after 20 minutes?
Well, I think if I were Mike Keenan standing behind the Flyers bench, I saw too much white going back and forth in front of me. The Flyers did an excellent job in the neutral zone when they were man down, and they did an excellent job during the first 6 or 7 minutes of the game when the Oilers really, I think, had the jitters, had the adrenaline jitters. After that, the Oilers seem to be cruising pretty well through the neutral zone, and that's where we talked about their zone to gain speed in, and they have a lot of it, the Anderson, Nielsen, Messier line, Gretzky, Curry, when they're out there with Tiekkanen. So I think Mike Keenan might want to clamp it down in the neutral zone a little more and stop that big white wave from coming, because if it continues, we have to point out once more that the Oilers really do have more snipers, more pure goal scorers than the Flyers do.
Many of you may remember the game in 1971. Henri Richard went around the right defense, Keith Magnuson, and was able to flip one in past Tony Esposito. And the goaltending duel that year was Esposito and the Conn Smythe winner, Ken Dryden. We're underway in the second period of Muni, hammered by Derek Smith. On with it flies Mark Messier. Turns it over to Nielsen. Nielsen had 5 shots in that first period, so Billy followed through on what he told you. He was going to shoot more often. He had 5 shots on goal of the 18 the Oilers had.
And you know, he's changed sticks too. I'm not even sure what brand he went from and which brand he went to, but all season long he used a certain type of stick, and I was able to pass him just when he was rushing from a quick interview before the game back into the locker room, and he said, I'm changing sticks tonight, I'm shooting more, and he said unequivocally that the area where the press conferences are held, which is between the ice surface and the Oilers locker room, would be occupied by him, by Kent Nielsen. He said, I will be there when the game is over, I will be there as a winner. That's how sure a lot of the Oilers were that they were going to win.
It is Peter Zezel controlling for Philadelphia, and Fuhr goes back to play over for Muni. Around it comes to Anderson. Stepped into by Tockett, and Messier can't flip it out as it bounces off Zezel. Tockett and Anderson tie up, and Anderson able to step away. This is a line that has figured in the only goal scored by the Oilers tonight, and a line that has had a lot to prove lately. Messier moves in, Anderson a shot, and that shanks off a Flyer leg. Going back for this is Ruotsalainen. Flyers want to make a change. They do. McCrimmon and Howe come out on defense, and it is Ruotsalainen sending one through to Messier with Jari Kurri. Messier drops. Kurri shoots, and it's saved by Hextall. Ron Sutter and Kurri tie in the corner. Puck fed, but off of Scott Mellenby. Mellenby for Philadelphia. Quick pass ahead was across two lines, stopping the clock. 18:41 to go in the second period. Our game is tied at one.
Here's a slow look at something that was happening real fast. Mark Messier crossing the blue line. Notice where Mark Howe is. They're back into the hash marks. The Oilers, when they come in a wave, if the Flyers want it back in, you know that they're going to shoot. So how many angles do we have covered? How big is this show? There are six different television feeds coming out of the Edmonton Northland Coliseum. 25 cameras, 21 replay machines, French, Canada, local Philadelphia, two English-Canadian broadcasts.
And you saw a number of still photographers there as well as McSorley hammers into Mellenby. Brad McCrimmon trying to reach it for Philadelphia and is able now to control. A minute and a half gone here in the second period. Series tied at three and this game is tied at one, and we're glad you've joined us tonight on ESPN. Greg Tapp, Mark Howe reacts for Philadelphia, connects with Ron Sutter, but his pass came to McSorley. Marty McSorley just pass ahead to McTavish, has an opening, moves in.
How does he do that? Incredible.
Ruotsalainen thought there was an icing there, but play continues, and now the Oilers regroup as moving in as McTavish. The play came across, and McCorley couldn't get it. Goaltending has just been phenomenal. It practically leaves us short of any sort of explanation. And Hextall has been a marvel. Grant Fuhr has as well. And because of Hextall's marvelous play and goal, Philadelphia is in this series and is in a game seven. Paul Coffey stepping ahead. Worked on by Daniel. Puck taken by Eklund. Three on three. Eklund moves in. Down on the lean of Kurri. Tockett centers one. But Gretzky has it for Edmonton. Quick pass because Daniel is there. And so it is Kekkonen. Laying it up on the wing for Jari Kurri. Kekkonen breaking. Kurri looking. Chased off by Crossman. Has to size up the play and gives it right up to Brian Propp. Propp moving ahead. Kurri knocks him down. 3:05 gone, second period. Wayne Gretzky peels back and hands to Muni. Muni plays on now to Kekkonen. Kekkonen scoreless in the last dozen games. For Kurri, but played back out by the captain of Philadelphia, Dave Poulin, and so it's Ruotsalainen once more. Pivoting away from the hook attempt of Sinisalo. Now it is Wayne Gretzky. Tested by Poulin, but the play made to Anderson up the wing. Ruotsalainen by the defense. Down he goes. There'll be a penalty coming up. 16:21 to go, second period. Game tied, 1-1.
We are seeing something in this game that we haven't seen too much of, and that is defenseman rushing. But here's a forward rush. It's Craig McTavish. Watch the save by Hextall. Oh, great move by McTavish. Following a great feed by McSorley. I think that's why they ended up with a 2-on-1. Mark Howe pinched, thinking that Marty McSorley couldn't get the puck up to that man, Craig McTavish. And we've seen it again. He is unconscious. What a save.
23 years old. And if you count the games in preseason, this is game 96 for Ron Hextall tonight.
It's a couple, isn't it? Mike, getting back to the point about the defenseman rushing, we've seen Paul Coffey tonight at least three times, Ruotsalainen at least three times, head it all the way up the ice themselves. They've got great legs. They skate very well. They haven't done it much in the series. And I suspect that that's one of the products of the closed practice that the Oilers had yesterday. No one was allowed in.
Coffey shot! And getting a stick on it, Hextall. Coffey has it once more. Gives off to Wayne Gretzky. Anderson a shot. That hit Huddy in front. And Charlie Huddy gets up and limps toward the bench.
Meanwhile, the play made by Ron Sutter for the shorthanded Flyers. 16 minutes to go in the second as Samuelson forces it back in. Ruotsalainen swirling. Some of the finest hockey players in the world are on the ice right now for the Oilers. Moving in is one of them, Messier. Gives to another, Gretzky. Gretzky fires. Blocked in front. Loose puck. Puck wide. And grilled back down by Brian Propp. A minute 20 to go on the power play. Five attackers, Oilers. Four defenders, Philadelphia. Gretzky drive. Ekstall Reed. Whips it back away.
There's the asset that we've seen so many times. The Oilers in the games in this series at the Northlands Coliseum here at Edmonton have done a great job of keeping the puck away from Ron Hextall. That's why. Every time he gets it, he's like another forward or defenseman back there. Oh, look out.
Here is Murray Craven, pursued by Ruotsalainen. Fires, and it's saved by Fuhr. He covers up, stopping the play.
That wasn't far off from going through the five hole, that space right between his legs. He came out to cut down the angle. But Murray Craven got a big shot away. They came very close to going between his legs. Watch how far to the net Grant Fuhr comes. See the space in behind him? See how he goes down? There's the space. Whoa. That was his check to see if he had it. And at the other end, Ron Hextall doing his magic. He had to go back the wrong way to get that one and make the save.
How would you like to be that cameraman? That's about 95 feet to the floor. And he's looking straight down on Ron Hextall. Play back in. 15 minutes to go. Second period, game tied at one. Seventh game, Stanley Cup Finals. Glad you're with us on ESPN. On with it is Anderson. Crosses. Anderson. Triple one in front, and it's reached by McCrimmon and cleared. 25 seconds to go on the power play. Fuhr sets it up for Paul Coffey. Pinching is Poulin. Centers one, but dealing with Randy Gray. Messier swirls for Edmonton. Shift change up front, Philadelphia. Final 10 seconds of the power play. Messier moves in, but the Oilers were offside.
And that's just about their last chance to get a shot on the power play. We're down to 8 seconds. And that offside pretty well cut off any chance of scoring on the power play. As we look at Wayne Gretzky, the single most dominant athlete in the history of professional sports. Can you imagine 7 Hart trophies consecutively as the most valuable player in the National Hockey League? And people that watch Wayne Gretzky frequently say, we can't appreciate him, and we never did until we got to see him a lot. And that's a quote that I remember mostly from Dan Maloney, who coached the Winnipeg Jets. He said, when I was coaching Toronto in the Norris Division, we didn't know that much about Gretzky. We knew he was the greatest. But now that I've seen him more often, I know just how brilliant he is.
Kelly Eklund through it, but Muni has it on the Oiler defense. Flyers move in, and Pocket puts the bump on Muni. Meanwhile, it's Kevin Lowe. For Marty McSorley. Checked by Tockett, play to Muni, then ahead to McTavish. Checked by Derek Smith, but he fights his way off. McTavish now forced off by Daniel, and Derek Smith punches it on ahead to Tockett. Gives to Eklund. It's a 2-on-2, and now a 3-on-3 as Tockett bends to Derek Smith, but he had to play at the board. Hunter wants to punch it back out and does. 13:45 left in the second period. In case you're just joining us, this game is tied at one. Wayne Gretzky along, got a leg on it to direct to McSorley. Just close one, it'll be chased down by the hero of the sixth game, J.J. Daniel. It is Coffey handing to Charlie Huddy. And Huddy on the turning stick of Wayne Gretzky. Now to Yari Kurri, but the pass was offside. 13:25 left in the second on goals by Craven and Messier in the first period. This one's tied at one. There are reporters. Broadcasting team is just a game away from living a dream. Bill, did you pretend it was the seventh game of the Stanley Cup when you were a little guy practicing outside?
Oh, I took it further than that. I think we all did. Well, we all do. I took it to scoring the winning goal. You know, I just wasn't in the game, Mike. That wasn't enough. You had to score the winning goal, too.
Now, did you broadcast it as you did it? Did you talk to yourself?
Absolutely. All the way.
Tikkanen with a pass onto Charlie Huddy. Wedged by Mellenby. And it comes into Mark Howe. Pass is tipped by Gretzky, gathered in by Yari Kurri. On with it is Paul Coffey. Does he get room? No. Tipped up. Play comes ahead to Gretzky. Away from one. Feeds off Tikkanen, and he was dueled all the way by Mark Howe on defense. Puck to Tikkanen. Forehander in front, sent away by Hextall. Craig with a drive. That one's blocked off on the sacrificial drive.
try to play one through, but it's punched deep, and Grant Fuhr goes out to handle it to Ruotsalainen. Given away to Ron Sutter, and Ruotsalainen back here. Sinisalo saves Fuhr! Wonderful action. On now comes Gretzky. Takes his own pass, but everything stops because of the offside.
Do you think any play could better fit the description of point blank than the chance that that man, Ilkka Sinisalo, just had on Grant Fuhr? He was left all alone because Sutter, here's Ruotsalainen, and Sutter intercepts it, and Sutter ends up pulling Ruotsalainen right through with him. Here comes Sinisalo. That's from the hash mark, the inside hash mark. Dead center, point blank. Here's what Grant Fuhr was looking at. Far too much orange and black up close, I'm sure, for Grant Fuhr. What a save. You got to understand that at this stage, too, his Weller trying to hit him, too. Grant Fuhr spreads so well with his legs. I'm surprised Sinisalo didn't try to go high on him.
Earlier today, we were thinking that maybe we were just too greedy to want a good close game here after we've seen such excellence. Greed or not, we're getting it. Samuelson on now to Zezel. Big drive by Zezel, handled by Fuhr, turned over to Craig Muni. They work it back along as the Flyers have made a change in personnel again, and this is Kent Nielsen. Nielsen pulls off, gives to Lowe, and Lowe moving in, just chased off and bumped by Craven. Lowe escapes, has a man in front, can't get it to him, and the reason was Brad Marsh, number 8. Samuelson for Philadelphia lost one out that is across two lines and grabbed by Sinisalo. 11:33 to go, second period, 1-1.
Another overhead look at Grant Fuhr, waiting, facing Ilkka Sinisalo, who had all the time in the world and all the room in the world. Grant won that one. You talked about his style being different than Hextall's, Mike. I guess it's only fitting that their styles be different because their personalities are so different. Mike Keenan has coached Ron Hextall all year. Keep in mind, he's a rookie. We sometimes lose sight of the fact Ron Hextall's a rookie. Mike Keenan says, he's as intense as I've coached. And Grant Fuhr is about as relaxed as you can imagine. Tries to sneak around a golf in between games and see him sitting out in the stands having a cup of coffee before it's time to hit the ice for the warm-up. Both wonderful in their own rights.
Bud keeps the action going so you can enjoy the deciding game of the Stanley Cup Finals. From Coffee, Missouri to McClellan, Iowa, Hunter, Kentucky, Anderson, Alabama, or Curry, Minnesota. Wherever across this great land you're watching the seventh game of the Stanley Cup Finals, for all you do, this Bud's for you. Eklund wins from McTavish. Play made by Crossman on the Philadelphia defense. Pinching is Charlie Huddy. A whack taken by Prop. The puck taken by Huddy for a drive to top the side of the goal, but a hand pass ruled against Edmonton. And so that again stops things with 11:23 remaining in the second.
There's another man that shaved his beard. I think I mentioned him in the first period. All the Oilers that were growing beard shaved him. You know, if you're sitting on the Flyers' bench, they're saying, guys, we got him on the run. They're panicking. And you try and draw from him every little thing, every little superstition you can. And I'm sure the Flyers are saying, ha, we force him to shave.
Huddy with a pass on up the ring to Hunter. And that one angled. Daniel to play. Away from McSorley. Prop trying for it. Daniel follows up, but here's McTavish moving in. McSorley, rising shot is tipped high by Doug Crossman on defense. McSorley flips off now for Dave Hunter. Crossman right after him. Gives him a couple of brush checks, and the puck turned over to Brian Prop of Philadelphia. Now advancing it is Daniel, has to try a second time, and shuffles off for Eklund, who stood up by McSorley. 10:40 remaining in the second, in case you're just joining us. This is a 1-1 tie. Philadelphia scored first on a 5-on-3 power play. Murray Craven at 1:41 of the first. Mark Messier for Edmonton on a tic-tac-toe passing combination from Anderson and Nielsen at 7:45. And there Grant Fuhr has just answered shot number 17 from a Philadelphia stick. On with it comes Paul Coffey. Feeds over. Backhander by McTavish to save. McSorley can't punch it home. And a chance by Craig went off the defenseman. Doug Crossman guides it. Steve Smith keeps it. Wrist one in front, and it skittered off Hextall and wide. McTavish behind, but it is Doug Crossman for Philadelphia. Halfway through regulation time of the period in the game. Down goes Prop. Up with it is Randy Gregg. Shuffles off to Tekin and then Gretzky over the blue line. And to prevent an offside, all of the Oilers regroup, and they have. Back in, Gretzky blast is off Crossman and wide.
Doug Crossman turning back for Philadelphia. Lays it up the wing for Scott Mellenby. Checked down by Smith. Randy Gregg with a little difficulty handling the puck, but then guides one that is away from Howe.
Boy, it's been a hard game, Mike. Nobody is skating by the check after they make the pass. They're following through. Everybody's paying the price.
Keegan and roll. Brad McCrimmon of Philadelphia takes it. It's swung further by Mellenby and tries to fight his way by Lowe, who doesn't budge. Mark Howe able to get the backhand on that one to prevent the Oilers rushing with it. Gretzky has to dip back for this pass to Muni. Then out for Tikkanen. Some trouble controlling, but feeds over for Yari Curry, who's forced deep again by Scott Mellenby's checking. This is Carson. Mellenby must get back out, or the Flyers would be guilty of offside, and they've done it. But Carson shanks it into low. Just like an arm wrestling contest. One arm forces the other, but ever so slightly. Then it's bent back a little bit. Shift change on, and Derek Smith comes out for Philadelphia, although the pass is through to Gretzky. Gretzky on with Tikkanen, has him breaking to the net, but the pass trickled through to Derek Smith in Philadelphia. 8.5 left in a tied second period, 1-1. Grant Fuhr watches as Poppy is there to play. Leaping check thrown by Peter Zezel. Puck punch too far for Nielsen. Samuelson rolls. Derek Smith has it. Centers one to Sinisalo. Oh. Save! Fuhr! Marvelous in the goal, Grant Fuhr. Can this continue? The score of the game, 1-1.
We have talked many times in this series about Grant Fuhr being a reaction goalie, and he has to be ready for all kinds of situations, including situations like that where Ilkka Sinisalo was left all alone to deflect. That's twice now. Sinisalo's got to be talking to himself. Two great chances from in tight on Grant Fuhr that Fuhr just stoned him on.
Some debris on the ice being tended to. 16 saves on 17 shots. At the other end, it is 23 for 24, Ron Hextall. There you see Finnish born Ilkka Sinisalo. He's the right winger on this line. Peter Zezel is the center, and the left wing, Derek Smith. The vital statistics you see, we are deadlocked in the series. That's why there is a seventh game, and in this contest at one. Charlie Hubby on for Mike Krusinski, his first shift of the night. Hands to Anderson, sized up by Marsh. The drop is to Messier. Flips one that Hextall didn't see but blocked. And the puck bounces off on the pass of Sinisalo, so Zezel applies the shoulder to Charlie Hubby. Messier fights by. Down he goes. Brad Marsh protests, but there'll be a power play coming up to the Oilers. The score of the game, Flyers 1, Oilers 1.
You have to know that every bounce is crucial, every play and every penalty is crucial. Brad Marsh is off for holding. We'll get a chance to see the Oilers power play again. 7:45 to go in the second period. We're tied at one. Big collision between Charlie Hudde and Peter Zezel. Zezel saw him coming. That's a bowling ball hit. Zezel's 5'9", 200 pounds. There is Marsh hog-tying Mark Messier and flipping him down. And that was the infraction that was called by Andy Van Helleman.
Oilers are 0 for 2 on the night on power plays, 4 for 23 in the series. Power play has been a little mystifying for the Oilers. They haven't been nearly as successful as they're accustomed to. Regular season, they weren't really as strong as they were used to either, so it's been a problem during the course of the year. Anderson wheels in. That one squirted away from him. Nielsen couldn't handle, but it's Huddy. Handing over to Paul Coffey. Fires! Trapped and held by Hextall.
Boy, what an opportunity. The whole side of the Flyers box was non-existent. There was no one there on Coffey's side. But you know what else wasn't there? A screen. Ron Hextall was able to see the shot all the way from Paul Coffey. See if we can figure out how they got twisted around. There are the two Flyer forwards on the left side. They just went out of your picture. Propp and Poulin. That meant that the man at the top of the box, you see them right here. One at the bottom, one at the top right. Those are forwards. They should be at the top of the box. They're not. They're on one side of the box. Coffey has clear access all the way to Hextall, but no screen. No one there to deflect. Right into the breadbasket. Easier save than you would think.
Paul Coffey waiting at the left point, matched up with Charlie Hudde on the right. Messier able to control, though he didn't win the faceoff. Messier danced around a couple of times. Now it's to Anderson. Wanted to point it, but keeps it.
Anderson gives to Messier, moves to the front, slots Coffey wide with the shot. And it is Charlie Huddy holding. Then to Nielsen. Duels with Poulin, puck to Huddy. Nielsen once more. Gives it back to Huddy. Draws it back. Save! Hextall hangs on. Crossman and Samuelson were taking care of things in front for Philadelphia.
And they sure were. You notice the difference in the Oilers' power play and a lot of other teams. Some teams like to get a guy in front, blocking and jamming. When the Oilers get the shot through, that's not their style, so they don't have anyone in front for a rebound. Here's the shot. Look at Coffey to the side. Messier is out trying to screen, but nobody is plugging away right in front of Hextall or turning to drive for the rebound. Super slow-mo will show you another look at it. Anderson, but Anderson really didn't put his nose down and dig for that rebound on Hextall.
Ron Hextall with that customary clanking of his stick on the pipe. When Philadelphia first won their championship in 1974, Ron Hextall was in grade four. You can imagine him banging his pencil on the side of his desk.
As a matter of fact, I was on that Flyers team and we knocked out the Atlanta Flames in the quarterfinals. Ron Hextall's dad, Brian, played for the Flames. We were talking about it tonight. I asked him how his son slept last night. He said he slept fine. My wife couldn't sleep. Ron was staying with his folks last night. My wife was up at 3 a.m. having a bubble bath. She couldn't sleep.
Crossman is in. Checked by Huddy, we get a stoppage of play as Ron Finn signals the puck had been played by a high stick. Ron Finn, one of the two linesmen working in the game tonight. Faceoff will remain in the Philadelphia defensive zone with 56 seconds now to go on the power play to Edmonton.
No, Doug Crossman had something interesting to say about playing in Philadelphia. When I played in Chicago, the only guy I met that played on the Stanley Cup winner was Dan Mikita, and I met him at a golf tournament. Here, I see Bobby Clark all the time, Bill Barber, Bernie Bronson, assistant coach. So we draw on that tradition. We can dip into that well of tradition that's there in Philadelphia. And I think to a man, the Flyers would admit that having that tradition and the actual players around that played on those championship teams with the same attitude that they had when they won is really a big, big asset to be able to draw from at this time of year.
That's what Jay and Ed Schneider had to be thinking when they brought a dozen sure. more from that team along for this trip.
Yep.
50 seconds to go on the power play now as they work it back to Coffey. He's got a man open. That's Charlie Huddy. Gives back to Coffey. And Coffey for Huddy. Off cutter. Pumped in front. Messier took a swing. Couldn't get it. It's back to Coffey. A shot. Deflected wide. Still they work for it and it's Glenn Anderson rolling it along to Gretzky. Coffey break. Puck swept away. Then a second flex by Hextall. Driven wide by Gretzky. Here, 22 seconds to go, power play. Paul Coffey gives to Gretzky. Looks it over. Broken up as his pass was stolen by Ron Sutter. And Sutter is all alone, though Crossman trying to fight his way along. That one just blocked away by Grant Fuhr. Oh, and a booming check thrown on Ron Sutter by Anderson, and Sutter retaliates not once but twice. Here is Sutter, checked by Charlie Huddy. Held to the boards. Stoppage of play.
I'm sure Anderson is wondering where Andy Van Helleman went. It was a crushing hit. Sutter was on his knees, and then Sutter retaliated a couple of times. Getting to be a pretty tense situation. There's Ron Hextall limping off, it looks. Another picture of the action in front of Ron Hextall. Samuelson 28 taking out Anderson 9. Remember, they had the big feud going in Game 6 in Philadelphia and have been at each other pretty well for this whole series when Samuelson has played. Saw Messier knock it down, but it bounced over his stick. He was just taking a swing at it. Boy, they were under the gun. When you're out there killing a penalty, you see it all collapsing and you realize you're clinging by a thread. Sometimes you cling and you get it back and you get it down the ice, and other times it ends up collapsing in the form of a goal. That time, the Flyers were able to hang on.
Marty McSorley tried to work it out, and it squirted further where Mark Howe can play, the son of the legendary Gordie Howe. The prop and then on to Tockett. Finesses for Eklund. Spins it up the wing, and a drive is high off pure by defenseman Brad McCrimmon. Puck taken by Tockett. Tries to roll it along, but it is Steve Smith on to McSorley. Then back to Steve Smith. Alley open, plays up the wing, but the play was offside, stopping the clock with 5:13 left in period two.
There's the man that went offside, but we can't fault Dave Hunter. Boy, at this stage of the game, at this stage of the season, those offsides are so key. That time, Smith made a little maneuver to the left at the blue line. That's what threw Dave Hunter offside. Super slow-mo of Grant Fuhr's last last save on Brad McCrimmon. What a great beat by Eklund. I'm really impressed at the way that the players seem to be in control of themselves and playing within themselves. The jitters are gone. Acrobatic, tight save, although he lands on his feet. But everybody seems in control. Eklund, who should make the big pass, is making the big pass. Gretzky's had a couple of routine passes snared, but he seems to be on top of his game. We've settled into a classic seventh game.
The man charged with trying to win the faceoff away from Wayne Gretzky will be Peter Zezel. Curry on the right of Gretzky, Tikkanen on the left. A prolific unit for Edmonton, to say the least, during the regular season, though it has gone sour on Tikkanen here in series 2, 3, and 4. Curry has shot, he scores!
What a transition from receiving the pass to turning and getting rid of the shot. Let's see what happens in the corner. There's Crossman with Tikkanen chasing, and Tikkanen runs him off the play. Gretzky to Jari Kurri, and before anyone can get to him, he does the transition. What a pass by Gretzky. Derek Smith can't get to him. So for the seventh consecutive game, all in this series, Jari Kurri and Wayne Gretzky pick up points.
Rousing ovation. So the script has changed. Philadelphia got ahead in the game, and Edmonton came back to not only tie, but now to go ahead. 4:45 left in the second. Gretzky getting the lone assist on the goal. McCrimmon has shot that's wide. Hops off Fuhr. Carson tries to feed. Howe able to keep. Wedges one that is snared by a leaping Grant Fuhr, and he'll hold on.
And he makes the relay to second base. What a shortstop-like move. Up in the air. You know who? I'm not even sure whether Tikkanen will get an assist on the goal. I haven't seen the official yet. But what a play he made, bumping Doug Crossman off the puck so that Jari Kurri could score. And we mentioned, Mike, you mentioned earlier, Tikkanen, here he comes. Tikkanen doesn't have a point in 12 games. And that's playing left wing. There he is, number 10, banging Doug Crossman off the puck. Wayne Gretzky anticipates well. You got to feel that there's a breakdown on the Flyers' part. When you see three orange jerseys standing there watching one white one shoot, there's a problem. Here's the Fuhr save. Up high.
Now that equipment he's wearing weighs about 35 pounds.
It'd be nice to tell a story that he could dunk a basketball even dressed in that equipment. Stretching the truth a little bit. But his agility, I think it can be compared with the agility of just about anyone in any sport.
Curry from Gretzky at 14:59. Curry's fifth of the series, 15th of the playoffs. And that has broken the deadlock of 1-1. It is Anderson feeding in front. Messier. Oh, and Hextall got a piece of the shot. Muni hit by Samuelson. Peeling off with it now for the Oilers and being hit, Krusilnicki. Muni spins one that went off Samuelson and wide. Rebound still tested for in front. Messier, oh, what a bad angle shot went wide. Low, swooned off by Cinisalo, and Messier really knocked flying the Flyer across the way, who gets up to have something to say about it, Rick Tocchet.
And I think Andy Van Hellemann is going to call a penalty. It certainly was delayed. He never put his arm up, and there's no question that Craven was smashed into the boards and that a boarding penalty could have been called. Watch this. Boy, cross-checking, you call it whatever you want it. And Andy Van Hellemann did call it. That's an appropriate call. Messier just buried him. I know that referees and the officials don't want to be really involved in the outcome, but in a situation like that, Andy Van Hellemann has to make the call, and he did. Mike, you know the thing that's impressed me most in this whole series about Grant Fuhr and Ron Hextall? When they've been scored on, and even when it hasn't been a picture-perfect goal, let's take that last one that Jari Kurri just scored. He comes back and makes a save like this one. They have never had two goals scored on them, one after the other, without a huge save in between. I'm not sure whether he got a piece of that one or not. It looks like he did. But they've always rallied. They've never crumbled, and they've always put up the brick wall as soon as one has gone by them.
The penalty to Messier is a charge. It comes at 16:02 and gives Philadelphia its third power play attempt on the night.
So easy when you're skating. I know what's going through Messier's mind. He sees Murray Craven vulnerable. Let's face it, we're in the seventh game. You want to start banging people right out of the contest. So he sees Murray Craven, vulnerable position, facing the boards, and he nails them. But Glenn Sather said it best before the game, said every player worth his salt has to be able to control his emotions. And it remains to be seen if that was an emotional penalty. You've got to be thinking at all times out there.
Murray Craven playing in this game with a broken foot. As on now comes Mark Howe, hooked at by Muni. Howe hooked at by Muni again, still battling. Taken by McTavish, but Eklund right there. That one flopped out of play. In case you're new to this series, we'll tell you that Philadelphia, according to their coach tonight, has five players in the lineup who in the regular season would not be playing because of injury. They're playing despite it. And it's been the Philadelphia story that they've had nothing but injury, and Edmonton not even a pimple.
There's one of the players who was injured earlier, had a Charlie horse. You know what was strange? The day before he was injured, I was talking to Mark Howe, and he said, you know, I can't stand being injured. I come to the building, and I get my treatments at the rink, and I go home right away because I can't stand being around the guys. It's as if I'm letting them down. There's so much pressure. I want to be there, and I just feel as if I'm not performing when I should be performing. Lo and behold, he has to get to Charlie horse the next night. Luckily, he was able to play. He was on the limp, but he played.
Gretzky on to McTavish, taken out by Howe. Mark Howe really got a break in coming back for that second game because there was a three-day layoff
right
between one and two. Eklund for Kropp, and he got the shot, and Coffey tries to clear. And it is at the blue line outside. And so offside is called. The puck must be all the way over the blue line. And then if it's brought back in as it was, offside stops the clock, and they face off at center ice.
Ron Finn had a good look at it, but it was close. That was either just outside or most of the way out. Very, very close.
When Philadelphia won it first up, Mark Howe, that was back in 74, was a rookie of the year in the WHA with the Houston Arrows.
What a splendid career he's had. Six seasons in the World Hockey Association, eight seasons in the NHL, 14 years of pro hockey, and if I'm not mistaken, just a couple of days ago, he turned 30, 31. And he scored over 1,000 points in his pro career, just about even, around 508 or 10 in the World Hockey and about the same in the NHL. Sometimes he goes unnoticed, but with those kind of numbers, he's headed for the Hall of Fame.
Eklund and McTavish just lays it back, a minute 15 to go in the Philadelphia power play, 3:10 left in the second period. Oilers leading the Flyers here 2-1. Coffey roll, Powell kick. And it is fed by Nielsen, cut off by Kropp, but given up to Paul Coffey of the Oilers. Another one flipped out of play. And Andy Van Helleman indicates outside the Oilers defensive zone is where they'll drop it. This is a guy who was in the seventh game of a Southern League playoff series for the Roanoke Valley Rebels and scored the win.
It was against Winston-Salem, wasn't it?
In overtime.
A plugging right winger, Mike Keenan. He was pretty loose last night. The whole Flyers team was. They did not skate this morning. They all went out to dinner last night and kind of hooped it up and had a good time. They were a very loose hockey team. That tells you the difference in these two teams. The Oilers closed practice yesterday. The Flyers actually did relay races using the sticks as batons. Tell you how loose one team was, and who knows how loose the Oilers were, but we can only guess. When we tried to talk to some of them after the game, they were a closed-mouth, tight-lipped bunch of guys.
Rattled and upset.
Yep.
On now, Crossman. Play made through to Craven, but he loses. 40 seconds left power play. They can't clear. Ryan Kropp taps in deep, then throws a high one on Muni. Puck cleared. Mark Howe trying to hold. Wrestles with Hunter, and Kropp has to go back to help out. Flyers are back on side. Puck flipped by Tockett. Misses for Craven. Slugged away by Muni. Cleared by McTavish. Every solid Oiler play met by one of the loudest cheers of the year. 12 seconds to go on the Philadelphia power play. Sinisalo has now moving in front. The shot tipped wide by Greg. 2-on-1. Gretzky and Curry with Samuelson back. For Curry, and he shanked it wide. And a big O from the crowd. And a relieved sigh at the Philadelphia bench. Mark Messier, as the penalty time has been killed off, teams at even strength. A minute 40 to go as Messier rushes. Gretzky fires past the Hextall. And the clock stops with a minute 37 to go. The score still is 2-1 Edmonton.
What a chance. That could have been the breathing room. With every, the breathing room the Oilers need, and with every chance, they're saying, Stanley Cup. Stanley Cup. This is it. Curry came way deep and then cut in for the net. I'm not sure Samuelson got a piece of that. You know what happens sometimes? You'll shoot it, and you'll end up going through the puck with your stick, and on your own recoil, if the puck is bouncing, you'll pull it back with your own stick. It's kind of a freaky thing. But Wayne Gretzky was looking past. It appeared all the way. Both Samuelson and Hextall read it pretty well.
Big defenseman who was part of a mid-year trade, which took a goaltender named Bob Frost from Philadelphia to the New York Rangers. Sinisalo forces off Coffey. Play made by Messier to Charlie Huddy with 90 seconds to go in the second period. Play made through to Kent Nielsen. Nielsen in front, and it's swept away by Hextall as Brad Marsh caught up to him and really denied Nielsen much of a chance. Ron Sutter on. Deals off Coffey, punches it away. Sutter regains. Then to Samuelson, but they've got to play at center ice. This one dumped along, and Sutter takes the man down. Nielsen follows up on the wing to Charlie Huddy. Huddy across. There's Anderson blocked by Hextall. Dropped along by Samuelson on the Philadelphia defense, and Anderson kind of jammed away. But it's Ron Sutter with 50 seconds to play in this middle period. As Lindsey Carson ahead, moves it over for Brad Marsh. Back cross ice, and Carson, in what appeared a broken play, jams one, but into Esa Tikkanen of the Oilers, who advances it to Gregg. Then along for Nielsen, but it's retrieved by McCrimmon. Striding forward is Al, bumped with Smith. But again, it's Hextall's play to make. Six shots, Philadelphia in this period. Oilers 13. Kevin Lowe back for an icing touch-up. And one of the rare icings in this game will bring the faceoff back near Hextall.
Every one-on-one so intense. Every time you see two players come together, try and watch closely, and you'll see the energy that's being expended. Nobody is taking the easy way out. They can't. There are no shortcuts to winning the Stanley Cup now. It's the team that wants it the most. Oh, a break would certainly mean something. Brad Marsh, great defensive play. He just gets his stick around Nielsen, gets the grab claw around him. Nielsen cuts over to try and brush in front of him. Nielsen makes the right play, so does Marsh. See the stick? Up under Nielsen, the long reach. Hextall steering it to the corner.
Here's the Hextall banging the pipes again. Puck back to Craig Muni. But Hextall will take this one himself. Rips it back off the glass. It misses McTavish. Off Muni. They still poke away at it, and it is Craven able to throw back out. 5 seconds left in the period. Hunter with the last throw, the last bounce off the board. As the siren goes, we're at the end of two. The Edmonton Oilers, 2. The Philadelphia Flyers, 1. A lot coming up for you between periods. Don't go away.
To tranquility of our Stanley Cup studios here in Edmonton. Mike, I hope you can get out of that place alive. You're doing a nice job, and so is Edmonton. They lead this game 2-1 after 2. And the road to the Stanley Cup is being brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? And by The Hartford, the insurance people of ITT. And by Budweiser, Beechwood Age for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. I feel safe to say those Flyer fans in New Jersey have downed a few Budweisers tonight, no doubt about that, as they try and root their team on. And the roar is now beginning to build in Northlands Coliseum as the Edmonton Oilers are taking the ice. They're faithful, hoping that the next 20 minutes will be all the hockey that's needed to play, and that their heroes will claim their third Stanley Cup in 4 years. The Flyers, of course, having other thoughts, trying to get their first cup in 12 years. Now let's go upstairs to the Northlands Coliseum for the third period. Here's Mike Emmerich, gentlemen.
Thank you, Tom. There were 13 Oilers shots in the second period. One of them got in, and that was Jari Kurri. His 15th of the playoffs and 5th of this series. The lone assist, Wayne Gretzky at 14:59. Two period totals are 31-18. Bill, 20 minutes, perhaps more to go, but it's the old saw. How do you protect a lead?
I think that's a question the Edmonton Oilers have been asking themselves, especially after games 5 and 6. They had the lead. They had 2-goal leads in both of those games and weren't able to hold them. And you know what's different about tonight? We're down to 20 minutes. They're not only protecting a lead, Mike, they're protecting the Stanley Cup. And that becomes a very big problem when you think about it that way. If they go into a shell, which means just continually dumping it out, not trying to generate any offense, you know the Flyers are always going to be coming at them and creating their own scoring opportunities. The Oilers tried that in games 5 and 6. It did not work. I suspect they worked on that in their closed practice the last couple of days. And we'll try it. We'll see them perhaps generating an offense, perhaps not being as conservative as we might think they'd be. 2-1, that's not a big lead against the Flyers, and they know it.
The big guns in this series, Wayne Gretzky, Brian Propp, Mark Messier, you see the impressive point totals. Now, these are overall in the playoffs, but Gretzky, Propp, and also Jari Kurri have been the top three in this series. If you turn the hands of clock back 2 years to when these two teams met for the Stanley Cup Finals, it was Gretzky, Coffey, and Kurri.
Still some familiar names up there. Messier is up there. Anderson's up there. Some of the best in the world right here.
And you see Dennis Savard, clever little centerman from the Chicago Blackhawks, was also one of the top six. But the big stats now, 2 Edmonton, 1 Philadelphia. This may be the last period. Nielsen moves in for the Oilers, jamming it along, and it is over to his line mate, Glenn Anderson. Off the stick of Mark Messier. And Brad Marsh connects with Samuelson. Off Anderson. Following up is Cinesano, but low right there, and gets help from Cure to turn to Nielsen. Along now to Messier, but pinching is Brad Marsh of Philadelphia. And a giveaway that Zezel fires, and a sprawling play made by Kevin Lowe. Outlet pass goes right through Nielsen, and Ron Hextall, the Philadelphia goalkeeper, just slugs it back onto Cinesano. Then along for Zezel, took the high hit from McTavish. Brad Marsh to take it with Tom Neese and Bill Clement, Mike Emmerich from the Northlands Coliseum in Edmonton. Game 7, Stanley Cup Finals. It's been a great one here tonight, and the whole series has been. If this is the first game you're seeing, just multiply what you've seen times 6. Play made, but by Eklund. It's retrieved by Charlie Huddy. Prop on back to Howe. A little bit of a feeling out period, it seems, here at the start of the third. A minute and 15 seconds gone. Hunter has it knocked away by Tockett and sent further by Billy Eklund. But Huddy turns right there to get it. You like pitcher's battles? This is what we're seeing in hockey. McTavish backhander hits the side of the goal. Turnarounder is through the crease wide. Eklund slides it back down. There have been home run derbies in the playoffs, but none in this series. It has been Grant Fuhr at one end, Ron Hextall at the other. This is Tekin in a drive off Hextall. And gathered in by Carson. On to Mellenby. Nicely gets by Kurri. Has it poke checked away on defense, though, by Randy Gregg. And this is Gretzky. Drive sealed off by Hextall. Buck poked into Shell Samuelson. Gretzky right back to test him again. But the play made by Ron Sutter. Out in front to Marsh. And Marsh outlets it for Philadelphia. Moving ahead is Lindsey Carson. Carson with a pick set moves in further. But it is Randy Gregg to take over. Just jams it off an uneven piece of the boards. And Fuhr comes out to freeze the puck. The score of the game remains. The Oilers 2 and the Flyers 1.
A look at the Edmonton Oilers bench. Without a helmet, Craig McTavish just had a good scoring opportunity on Ron Hextall. Here he comes. On a sharp angle, you see the puck bounce up on edge and then sit back down. Went through Hextall's legs off the side of the net.
It is Mike Krusielniski for Edmonton. That one knocked down by Anderson, brought in by Mark Messier. Just lays it in deep, and it's Hextall controlling for Philadelphia. Bud keeps the action going so you can enjoy this deciding game of the Stanley Cup Finals. Howe, Idaho, Carson, Mississippi, Stanley, New York, Marshfield, Missouri, or Sutter, California, anywhere across this great land, you're watching tonight's game. We hope you're enjoying it. We sure are. And for all you do, this Bud's for you.
What a gutsy playoff year Dave Poulin has had with his broken ribs, wearing the flak jacket that he threw all the way out west of, I believe, the San Francisco area to have it custom made. Came back in the seventh game of the Islanders series only to aggravate his ribs, but to play such a huge role in that one period where he picked up 2 key assists and the Flyers went on to defeat the Islanders in the seventh game. It's been a year full of grit for the Flyers, all kinds of injuries. They led the league in man games, lost to injuries. Somehow they fought their way all the way here to the seventh game.
Ruotsalainen rolls, Hextall plays. Flips it along, hoping for Zezel. It rolled off Derek Smith's stick. And it is Ruotsalainen once more for the Oilers. 17 minutes to go, third period. The Oilers have outshot the Flyers, 33-18, have a narrow lead, 2-1. Kent Nielsen controlling, surrounded by Flyers, but it's Randy Gregg moving in, and the shot into Hextall, he covers.
Well, he had lots of protection around him that time. Kjell Samuelsson was standing there, Zezel was looking out for him. It's one thing to get that shot in on him, like Randy Gregg just did, but the Oilers haven't capitalized on anything even close to a rebound. Here's Anderson up to Nielsen, who pulls it in. Crosses the line, taking all kinds of lumber from Scott Mellenby. Boy, you see the traffic and the concentration. Now watch Gregg's shot. You won't see any Oilers anywhere near the net for the rebound. Gregg has a chance to line it up. There's the shot that will drop down. No one is there. All there is orange and black around him.
Hextall peers out at the faceoff that is won by the Oilers. Gregg, a drive, hits the goal post. And Anderson spins one in front. It hit off Nielsen and went wide. Messier hoisted off by Ron Sutter. And again, the Oilers hear the clank of iron. Ruotsalainen going back to gather it in for Edmonton. Double forechecking now for Philadelphia, and that one rolled through Brad McCrimmon down.
Same kind of deal, Mike. The Oilers have to be wondering, shaking their heads. That's two posts they've hit. It's got to be a deja vu situation for them after games 5 and 6. They can't put them away. They can't put the Flyers away. They're still only ahead by one. You know that the Oilers are sitting there, if not literally, figuratively biting their nails, saying, what are we going to do to get one by this guy? We should have blown them out in two periods, in the first period of game 5 and the first period of game 6. And if things aren't bad enough with Hextall stopping it, they're banking in off the post, or at least out off the post. They're not going in. Boy, when you're hot, you're hot. And he's getting help from his post, help from everywhere.
Murray Craven of Philadelphia, as we watch this one go sailing through again. There it
That's
was.
The one, and it was so close to going in that it actually came out between Hextall and the other post.
Murray Craven of Philadelphia was asked, how many times can you do this? How many times can you come from behind and beat the Oilers? He said 4. I think we can do it 4 times. We'll see. They've done it 3. Series tied at 3, but the Oilers leading 2-1 and now an even 16 minutes to go. McCrimmon rolls. Coffey sends one in front that went by Hunter. Puck taken by Mark Howe. Directed further by Brian Propp of Philadelphia, but gathered in by McSorley. Pivoting away, Marty McSorley. Gets away from McCrimmon, crosses, but it's checked off by Howe.
Good play by McSorley. You know, Mike, that's the kind of play where 9 times out of 10 in another game, McSorley might have just jumped it in. He went for it and almost had a good scoring chance.
McTavish down, shoveled it wide. Brad Marsh along, stopping to play, and now McTavish and Hextall roughing it up in the goal crease.
Look at Andy Van Helleman. He went right in and ripped the net right off his post. What a great move. Van Helleman knew that his official, his linesman, couldn't get in there. Ron Pinn couldn't get in there. D'Amico couldn't get in. So what did Van Helleman do? He went and ripped the net right off his mooring so that they could get in from behind. Boy, McTavish was just getting it from Hextall, though, when he was down. Here's a look at it. McTavish going in. Now, that should be a penalty, and I got a feeling that Andy Van Helleman might have been looking to call that one. You can see that Hextall came right down on McTavish immediately, and he doesn't stop here. He's giving it to him. Like he's got him against the turnbuckle, and he pulled something out of his trunk. Here's the collision, and Hextall starts with the left hand. He eventually gets rid of his stick and starts drilling him with the right hand. McCrimmon moves in. There it is. There's the right hand going at it.
Looked as though McTavish was holding on. And
there's the net. Andy Van Helleman pulled it right off.
Peace restored for now. 15:29 left in the third. Oilers 2, Flyers 1.
Mike, think you and I have been sitting here having a difference of opinion. You were saying that...
Well, it looked like Hextall was being held, and he wanted to get back up to continue play. But what did you see?
Well, I'm maintaining that right now McTavish is clinging to his life. We saw what happened to Kevin Lowe when he scored a goal and got in tight. I mean, that's no place to end up caught up with Lon Hextall. So, in my mind, McTavish is trying to protect himself by getting in close.
John Ziegler, the president of the National Hockey League, and on the right, and Brian O'Neill, the executive vice president of the league, on the left. Some debris tossed on the ice and some liquid as well that has to be taken care of. There are some penalty calls, but we've not gotten the announcements yet. Mike Keenan, you just saw, waiting with interest to hear what the decision of Andy Van Helleman will be. The score remains 2-1 Oilers.
It's in Ron Hextall's crease. McKinnon dives for the puck. Notice he does not get the puck, but he takes down Craig McTavish. And perhaps it was the shot that Craig McTavish got away that turned Andy Van Helleman against calling the penalty on Brad McKinnon. We'll probably never know.
There are two Flyers in the penalty box. There are two Oilers. There are no penalties up on the board, so we're assuming cancellation, as just now they're being announced. Roughing to all. McTavish, McSorley, Hextall, Tockett.
You got to be a pretty tough guy to get 2 minutes for roughing when you're lying on your back with Ron Hextall pummeling you with both hands, don't you? 2 minutes for receiving. Craig McTavish gets.
Now, neither team, because of those penalties, are short in manpower on the ice. It's full complement of skaters for both. And we have 15:22 to go. Tikkanen, roll. Gretzky is there. Centers for Curry. From Mellenby, hit hard by Kevin Lowe.
He had a score to settle. Mellenby had really roughed up Kevin Lowe in front of the Flyers bench.
It is Hextall whipping it back over to Howe, and Howe run off the play by Tikkanen after he released that one down. Mellenby back and Lowe there, and we get a stoppage of play on an offside pass. Both teams are really warming and heating up in temperament now. It's something that we didn't see before.
Ahead by one, third period, game seven, and as much as the tempers heat up, everyone's head has to overrule their heart at this stage of the hockey season. You can't get any further than this. You know, Bernie Perron was saying to Mike Keenan before game six, we were all sitting around chatting, Bernie walked in and said, Mike, you know what you have to tell the players? You're two games away from winning the Stanley Cup. Lo and behold, the Flyers win game six. Here they are at game seven. I'm sure Mike said, guys, you're one game away. Now both teams are less than 15 minutes away. The Oilers have the lead.
Dinisalo nudges ahead for Brian Propp. Messier puts the wedge on him. He and Propp continue. And Messier reached out and just flexed that one along to Kent Nielsen. 14:35 to go in the third. Oilers outgunning the Flyers. They lead the game 2-1, about shot them 34-18. Anderson wraps. Messier there. Samuelson and Messier came up high and hard on him. Anderson cranks one, and that went off Brad Marsh and into the seats. And how many times in these last 8 weeks has Brad Marsh been in front of a shot?
Lots. Ron Hextall just gave him a big swat in the seat of the pants with his stick. For a second there, it took me back to the slashing game when Ron Hextall leveled Ken Nielsen. He wound up, but it turned out to be a tap of affection on Brad Marsh, and Brad Marsh turned around. You know, Brad Marsh gets along with every goalie that he's ever played with, and I played with Brad. He is such a player's player and a defensive player that there isn't a goalie that's ever played behind Brad Marsh that didn't respect the way he played. And as a penalty killer when I played, I respected the way Brad Marsh played as well, because he was such a giver. He just would do virtually anything that had to be done in a defensive capacity to try and save a hockey game. Throw his face in front of the shot, his legs, his feet, it didn't matter.
The discipline from the Flyers' standpoint, 14:21 to go, and they're behind by one, is not to do something foolish that's going to give Edmonton a power play. What about the Oilers?
Well, they they have to be of the same mentality. Control. How many times have we talked about the things the Oilers have acquired in the playoffs that they never had before? Patience and discipline. Once again, the test of patience and discipline is going to come right at the Oilers.
Crossman, Engel, Charlie Huddy there to take it. Gives it up, though, to Craven. Rolls it along for Mellenby. But it trickled through as he was chased off by Coffey. Huddy given a hit, but directs to Gretzky, and out it comes to Tikkanen. They're two on two, and Tikkanen's drive hits the goalpost. That's the third one. Peter Zezel pivoting. And flipped back out for Mellenby. Shovels off for Brad Marsh.
Mike, if I'm one of the Oilers, now I'm really worried. All the chances they've had, they haven't been able to widen the lead. They have to be sitting there saying, oh, no. Is it going to happen again?
They want to let Gretzky take because that brings a whistle. And the faceoff will be well outside the Flyers' zone.
There's the man that hit the post. Picked up his first point tonight at 12.
I agree. Yeah, I'd say the same thing. I don't think I've seen him shake.
Yeah, but he knows the camera's on him. Here it is. He cranks it up from just inside the blue line. Oh, boy, they've got to be shaking their heads. You know, Hextall is way out to cut down the angle. That tells you what a fine line Tikkanen's shot was going for. There's not much room on that side of Ron Hextall, and he dinged it right off the post. Great blast.
I couldn't say anything in Finnish, though. Young man from Helsinki has nearly gotten his first goal in three series, but there have been three nearlys, and if you count Curry on the two-on-one breakaway shanking the shot, perhaps being defended off by Samuelson, that's four great opportunities. Three off post and one not converted. Here is Lowe. Tries to wrap around for Nielsen. High drive, and that one sailed into the seats. 13:20 to go in this third period. With Tom Neese and Bill Clement, Mike Emmerich from the Northlands Coliseum, Edmonton, Alberta. Beautiful weather outside today, 65 degrees and sunny. Inside, tension, also enthusiasm for this Oilers team that at one time had the Flyers where they wanted them, 3-1, but couldn't put them away.
They had them where they wanted them, even more than that, didn't they? In game 5, 6, they had them right where they wanted them. But then it got so ridiculous to turn around as a lot of people were walking around saying, well, the Flyers have them right where they want them now. And perhaps that's what some people are saying now, because the Oilers are leading the Flyers, and they just have not been able to hang on to it in the third period.
Flyers team using a rookie goaltender whose first game was against Edmonton on opening night, and he won it 2-1. Gave up the first shot on goal for a goal and stopped the next 21 to win. Who'd have thought then that it would have gone this far? McCrimmon a shot. Blocking it with a butterfly move was pure. Around now to Mike Krusielniski. Outlets for Anderson, but it's quickly to Mark Housedick, then to McCrimmon. Turning it to Sinisalo, and back again McCrimmon and Nielsen. Darts right after him to force his hand. It's Zezel. Crunched by Anderson, but the play made to Carson. But the result of the Anderson check breaks this Flyer play down.
That's some pretty good neutral pressure by the Oilers. That's a page out of the Flyers book. Stop him in the neutral zone, and the Flyers buzzed everywhere but couldn't get it through the neutral.
Paul Coffey, watched by Howe, and the shot saved by Hextall. Back up with it comes Brian Propp. This is a one-on-one, and the Oilers hurry back. Big shot by Propp, blocked by Huddy, and grabbed off by Fuhr. Paul Coffey, off the forechecking of Tockett. Dug out by Propp to Eklund. Eklund turns the net, centers one, but only Kent Nielsen is there for the Oilers. 12.5 minutes to go in the third. The Oilers still leading in the seventh game of the Stanley Cup Finals, 2-1. Messier rolls deep. Danio to get it for Philadelphia. The forechecker is McSorley. Forces him back deeper. And then he hits the back of the goal. Crossman clears, but Steve Smith keeps. He forces Hextall to slug this one. Whirls off, and Hunter tried in close quarters to get it to Greg and has to play again. Tockett can't handle, but it's Danio back, and McSorley swooping on him again. This one is ripped back around for Rick Tockett. Tockett just bats one back further, but it is Greg controlling on the Oiler defense. Flyers in the midst of a shift change, and so Hextall flings one back out. Muni going back to play for the Oilers. He's matched up on defense with Kevin Lowe. Forechecking nearly broke it for the Flyers. Samuelson with a drive that is tipped by Craven. Dug out, though, by Dave Poulin. Poulin fourth, gives it up to McSorley.
Good coverage by the Oilers.
A three-on-three, and McSorley, that one's knocked down, and diving is Hextall to hold on. 11:21 to go, third period. Edmonton 2, Philadelphia 1. Center may be seen immediately following our hockey coverage, including highlights of Davey Allison's second win of the year at the Bud 500, College World Series, French Open. Chris Berman and Gail Gardner will have it all for you. And plenty after the game from the locker rooms as well. Offside called against the Oilers, and the clock stopped with 11:16 to go in the third. Tom Meese and Bill Clement will be downstairs at the conclusion of the game.
As we look at one of the great clutch players, Jari Kurri, he's underrated defensively, he's fabulous offensively. I'm reminded of something that Scott Mellenby said in the locker room following Game 6, and the Flyers hadn't let this out very much. He said, you know, we think we're in better shape. They used it against the Rangers. The Flyers were very quick to point out they thought they were in better shape. They haven't mentioned it too much against the Oilers, but, you know, I believe they do think they're in better shape, and, you know, I really don't believe that it matters one way or the other whether they really are, as long as they believe they are. And I think that's one of the secrets to their comebacks in the third period. They always think they're going to have the legs to get scoring opportunities, and sooner or later, catch up. It's not like they lost a hockey game. It's just like they ran out of time when they don't win, and they've just been able to catch up in games 5 and 6.
This is Mark Howell moving on. Gives to Eklund. Eklund has a man breaking. McCrimmon threw it right in the pile, and McCrimmon able to control. Spins one in front, and McTavish bumped into Fjord. Puck rolled back out by Hunter. Howe and McCrimmon, the defense pair for Philadelphia, playing catch with it as the clock ticks down to 10:50 to go in the third. The Oilers have had a 2-1 lead since 5:01 remain in period two. That's when Kurri scored from Gretzky to break the 1-1 tie. On comes Markow, gets away from Lowe. Then a backhander by Propp is sent away by Fjord. Reaching it is Howe, along for Tocchet, but he's locked up with McTavish, pulls away. Deep slot, Eklund, a shot, tipped wide. Moving in is Lowe once more, trying to get away from Howe, who centers. Puck pops back, and Eklund can't get a shot away. Good checking done by Hunter. 2-on-1, McTavish to McSorley. McSorley feeds, and a diving play made by Brad McCrimmon. McSorley trying once more, lays it around the board, waiting for it is Brian Propp. Constant attack met by almost constant resistance. 10 minutes to go in the third. Paul Coffey turns by Howe, curls the net, sliding play again made by McCrimmon, who clears.
Boy, when Paul Coffey gets it going, what a burst of speed he had to go around Howe. But that's the way Howe and McCrimmon play. When Howe is beaten, McCrimmon seems to be almost always there to back him up.
Hextall on the turning stick of Poulin. Feeds it across to Shel Samuelson. Then Sinisalo, wrapped up by Coffey, and Samuelson forces it further. Charlie Huddy pivots to play. Away from the sweep check of Shel Samuelson, who's in deep from the defense. It's popped loose, and Samuelson keeps it moving again and walks one wide. Huddy pursued, but a hook checking Murray Craven. Poulin trying to get to it. Puck kicks back to Messier. Has Nielsen breaking, but Samuelson in the way. Four good reaches in this last shift by the big defenseman, Shel Samuelson. He comes to the bench for a shift change as the puck is handed to Steve Smith. Then out to Kurri, wants to lay it along, but instead it's played over to Crosby. J.J. Daniel back. It's hacked further by Ron Sutter. You're behind. Under 9 minutes to play. Non-stop action, and that's been the case all night. Daniel a shot, and that one snared by Fjord. Now Sutter and Randy Gregg, and then stepping into it as well as Scott Mellenby.
Boy, somebody came in and grabbed Ron Sutter. Asa Tikkanen, number 10.
It has calmed, but still 8 minutes and 46 seconds to go. And the score is still Edmonton 2, Philadelphia. They have seen so much here. They opened the arena in 74, and they were still stanchioning in the seats the night the Alberta Oilers played with Jacques Flan in goal. Ali and Semenko for charity in the summer of 83, and Ali handing out a bloody nose. They've seen some of the finest players in the world here, and included the best of the lot, who arrived at age 17 back in 1979, Wayne Gretzky. And now they're seeing seventh game Stanley. Stanley Cup Finals and their team ahead. 2-1, 8:46 to go. Ron Sutter won the faceoff but couldn't get to it. Smith whirls it back out, and it's Mark Howe playing on the Philadelphia defense. Hands it to Sutter, and had he been able to turn and accelerate, he'd have had a breakaway. Derek Smith stood up by the hard check of Greg. Back up comes Messier. Feeds on the wing to Curry. Big drive into Hextall, and he hangs on.
The guns are out. Messier is out. Gretzky, Jari Curry. Now, you got to figure Messier is out there to take the draws deep in his own end to try and win the faceoff. But, man, when he gets the puck and starts heading up ice, what an awesome trio coming at you. Messier over to Jari Curry. Hextall once again having faith in number 10, Brad McCrimmon. Hextall way out of his net, knowing that if Jari Curry decides to make the pass, McCrimmon's going to cut it off.
In other years, I remember more noise during stoppages of play, but there can't be the confidence here that they've had in prior years. 37 shots, two have gotten in. At the other end, 20 from Philadelphia, with one getting into the net. They don't get any closer. We're down to the last 8:20. Rick Tocchet over, punches it further, but Paul Coffey is guarding the line. Coffey for the Oiler defense, turning it back along to McTavish, hands over to Dave Hunter. Hunter gets away from Tockett's check, but then Tockett outreached him to turn it around. Ron Sutter had it knocked away by Coffey to Hunter. Gives to McTavish, and the shot off Brad Marsh's leg. Sutter starts it back out, gives across to Marsh. Angles for Brian Propp, but the Oilers see it swung around from Grant Fuhr. Charlie Huddy on defense, drops it over to Coffey. Messier and Curry, the goals for the Oilers. Murray Craven had the first goal of the game, and that for Philadelphia. Here's Nielsen trying to get there, but Tocchet outreached him again. And it is Propp punching, but Anderson taking. Crosses with Nielsen. Anderson, forced off by Marsh. Tries to get to the front, one-handed one. And Shel Samuelson again with the long reach, punched it away. Lowe lofts it. Marsh chasing. Messier after him. Slams into the board. Marsh. Pressed by Anderson. The give is to Messier. Anderson just taken right out of the play by Shel Samuelson. Puck fed to Lowe. Wraps it around. Anderson can't reach. Greg there. Checked by Brian Propp. Then Marsh ties up his man. Nielsen spins. Wants to get a shot away. Wedged off. Drive. Blocked off in front as that one hit Messier, who's down in pain. Back up now comes Brian Propp. On to Sinisalo. Then to Propp. A shot off a leg. And the puck swung back out by Grant Fuhr. Daniel takes him. Bill, what were you watching?
What a hit Randy Gregg laid on Brian Propp, or Sinisalo rather, when he came across the blue line. You know what the Oilers are doing tonight that they didn't do in game 5 and 6? They're not changing. They're playing exactly the way they have throughout the entire game. And you know what? It's working for them.
It's working for them as the score. Mark Messier hurt and in pain. His team leading 2-1.
Take a look at the shot that hits Mark Messier. Right in the ankle. And as we speak, he is sitting on the bench. He had his head actually resting on Glenn Anderson's shoulder, his line mate's shoulder, had a hold of his arm, and was squeezing it just about as tight as he could, I imagine, trying to get the pain to go away.
Doug Crossman centers one in front. That's checked loose by Gretzky. Oh, and Poulin wouldn't let it get by. But they're forced to center ice nonetheless as Daniel brushes. Can't get his man. Curry steps back in. Jari Curry, a shot blocked down. Rebound, trickle off the side of the net. Still they fight for it. Wayne Gretzky tries to center. Curry with another try. Pivoting on him is Daniel.
You see, Mike, how they're not afraid to have two men in. Gretzky's in, Curry's in. When Messier was out there, it was Messier and Anderson. They're not sending one man in. They're continuing to forecheck with two men in. The Flyers can't get out.
This is Coffey. Forced behind by Craven. A man is bear hugged in front. Doug Crossman has his man wrapped up, and that'll cost one penalty, maybe two.
Asa Tikkanen.
Well, the Oilers were freewheeling, weren't they? Really starting to get the chips going.
Paul Coffey is pinching in when he has to, and he's always being backed up. It's not the conservative shell that we saw in games 5 and 6. And the Flyers are having a terrible time getting out of their end. And you wonder what went on in the closed practice that no one saw, that Glenn Sather had. I'm sure a lot was said about, listen, guys, if we're going to go down, let's go down playing the way we play best. Let's continue to take it to them right till the end. Not in a crazy way. Let's not open it up and take chances that are going to cost us goals. Back each other up. Paul Coffey, when it's time for you to pinch in and go right in behind Ron Hextall's net, go ahead. Marty McSorley will be there to back you up. Dave Hunter will be. And 5 minutes and 44 seconds to go. Lots can happen. But this is a different Oilers team than we saw in games 5 and 6. They've really held their ground well here.
The ovation that you're hearing is that Marc Messier just took a little practice turn on the ice in front of the bench. And the fans here standing, knowing that their big centerman is back and healthy.
Did you see Ron Hextall lose his balance? I think he had a strap loose on his left pad. You can see a strap. There was a glint of it dangling between his legs. Here's the Tikkanen Doug Crossman altercation.
Philadelphia may be taking time out here. Crossman gets 2 minutes for holding. And Tikkanen 2 minutes for roughing. Well, no, there's no timeout. It's a shattered bottle.
We're talking broken glass there. How'd you like to get hit in the head with one of those?
It's just so thoughtless. And if you need any evidence, talk to a guy from the Minnesota North Stars sometime about what happens when debris is on the ice. But glass. Guy from the North Stars we were referring to, Dino Cicerelli, stepped on a piece of debris, went headlong into the boards, broke a leg, had to have a 15-inch rod put in his leg.
Mike, I'm not sure Marc Messier is going to be able to go. That was his second spin. And he still looks as if he's in a lot of pain. But if his team can hang on, each player will receive $25,000. That's beside their place finish. Here's another look at the shot that hits Messier's ankle. So the Oilers, should they hang on, will receive $25,000 a man. The Flyers as losers if the score doesn't change. $18,000 a man. And you can add $5,000 for conference wins. That total $30,000 for the winning team and $23,000 for the losing team. But we've seen the Flyers do it before. I mentioned that the Oilers win 30 only if they hang on to win. 5:44 to go in the third.
Those youngsters like you once were, Bill Clement, who circled in the basement or perhaps out in the driveway if it was frozen, or where their parents made ponds for them in the backyard with a hose every late fall when it started to get below freezing constantly. Never really thought about money when they thought about the Stanley Cup. They just thought about that big trophy.
Even now, they're not thinking of the money. They're thinking of the ring, the honor, and the lifelong dream realized. Ron Hextall, what would it be like for him to win a Stanley Cup in his rookie season?
Does Curry have the game winner, or will it come later? It is 2-1 with 5:40 to go, third period. Mark Howe gives up to Lowe, quickly for Hunter, but it ricocheted back, and puck out of play. Bob Kelly and Rick McLeish, the two men who got the game-winning goals in the deciding game of the Stanley Cup for Philadelphia, are here tonight. Ken Lintzman had the first Oiler clincher. Paul Coffey had the one in 85.
You know, if Marc Messier can't make it back out, we haven't seen him, he's a key loss. Even though there are only 5 minutes to go, if the Flyers can get down, penetrate, get some faceoffs, Messier is the number one draw man for the Edmonton Oilers. They'll be without him if he can't skate, and I'm not sure that he's going to make it back.
Lowe, Greg, McTavish, and back in. Clock ticks down to under 5.5. With it is Samuelson, forced by McSorley, but along it is sent further, and Ron Sutter in stride, hoping to get to it, though Greg arrives first. Little chipper, and Hextall there flings it away from Marty McSorley. Marsh allowed it to go, and it's McTavish moving in. Wedged off by Ron Sutter. Marsh punches, but it's Dave Hunter retrieving. Sutter and McTavish once more. Hunter along. Samuelson right after him to press him up against the boards.
Oh, what a battle McTavish is having. He's trying to get his glove back on at the same time as he's battling Ron Sutter. He had lost his glove, and in the middle of it all, reached down, picked it up. Somehow he has it back on. What an unsung guy. Craig McTavish has had a brilliant series against the Flyers. And here's Messier. He's back.
Another standing ovation for Marc Messier. Boy, there's been so much emotion packed into this series, the Flyer series, to reach here. I'm sure there were some, though it wasn't with the same threat that the Oilers felt when they went by Los Angeles and then Winnipeg, had a scare from Detroit.
Oh, there's been no sense of urgency like we're seeing now. Mark Messier is back. Wayne Gretzky says people would be surprised if they knew just how much Mark Messier meant to my career. I don't play on the same line with him. I hardly ever get on the ice at the same time. But he says, believe me, he's meant a lot to my career and has helped it.
And of Ron Hextall, Gretzky said, the best goalie I ever faced. Hextall has faced 39 Oilers shots. At the other end, Grant Fuhr has faced 20 from Philadelphia and only two in this period. The puck comes back to Huddy for a shot directed away by Hextall. It is Tocchet with a pass that skips through. Brian Propp wants to fidget it further, but it's Messier in the way. Shovels off for Anderson, and that caromed off the line to nearly to him. Rolled out by Samuelson, sent further by Tocchet, but again it's Messier. Seems to have great turning ability, Messier, despite taking that one on the ankle. Nielsen pivots and forces the Flyers' defense. 8-28. Martian Samuelson to turn once more. Messier runs into Samuelson. Nielsen to Anderson, and the shot wide. Huddy with 4:15 left in the third. Hands it to Paul Coffey. Forechecking is Brian Propp, but it's broken with the pass on to Anderson, then to Wayne Gretzky. And Gretzky drops it deep. Don't recall calling Gretzky's name that much here in the third period. Play made over to Samuelson by Zezel and by Propp. Gregg misses for Gretzky, and it is Brad Marsh away from Trusselniski, turning it on to Propp, who has to hurry it back to Marsh. Oilers are doing some swooping now. Hextall again back, hurries it the other side, and Curry keeps it in for the Oilers. Zezel with 3:40 to go, along to Craven. Oilers keep again. Oh, and off Hextall to the outside of the goal. How close, and it comes.
That could have been the Stanley Cup. Sealed, signed, delivered right there on the deflection by Wayne Gretzky. The Oilers have been so dominant in the last 10 minutes of this hockey, and there it is between the legs. If it doesn't hit Hextall's right pad and come back this way, it's in. Another look at it. Notice how deep the Edmonton defense are able to move in. They're not shying back. They're not pulling out. Randy Gray stood his ground and made the play here to Gretzky. Hextall just nicked it. What's the best defense? Play on the Flyers' end, and the Oilers have done that pretty consistently for the last 10 to 12 minutes. Forechecking, great forechecking by the Oilers. The Flyers have only had two shots on goal the whole period. So what have the Oilers changed? Well, they're not trying to protect the lead by sitting on it. They're forechecking as aggressively as they were at the beginning of the game and having great success.
Fans are now stomping their feet. They'll do more if it's the same score 3.5 minutes of playing time from now. It is Howe on the turning stick of Poulin. Sends to McCrimmon and up to Scott Mellenby. Gregg tied him up and the pass couldn't be completed to McCrimmon. Moving in is Sutter, checking with McTavish. Trying to work further and poking at it now is Dave Poulin. Still wants to kick it along. Two aside, and the fifth man, who so often gets it, does this time Dave Hunter. Striding back for it, McSorley. Hextall coming out, turned it into McSorley, and the puck skidded high in the air to be played by Howe. Under 3 minutes to go. Such wonderful action we've seen in this playoff coverage on ESPN, and it's been a splendid one tonight. So all Oilers, it seems, here in the third. On now comes Mark Messier by Howe. Messier in front, diving play made by Hextall. Mark Howe took some lumber from Anderson, but keeps it moving with 2.5 to go. The puck wound up going off Craven. Anderson can't control as Howe punches it away. Anderson following up once more. Big drive, score!
Front. And after the goal by
by Glenn Anderson, Mark Messier raised his arms in the air and very slowly glided, not to the pack of players that were congratulating one another, but all the way slowly to the other end of the ice, saluting the fans, releasing the tension, the pressure that these guys have felt. And you know that this man hasn't given up yet. There's 2 minutes and 23 seconds to go. And until Ron Hextall hears the final buzzer, he won't quit.
Cuddy, checked by Brian Kropp. Coffey turns it over to Curry. And it's laid back down. Well, we've talked so much of fire, Curry. And then Mark Messier, painful injury, comes off and becomes a force in this game. We'll get the official scoring. Anderson at 17:36. We don't have the assists as yet. Tocchet flips one ahead to Brian Kropp. Feeds over to Eklund. Can't steam by the defense as they close ranks, and Greg flicks it away. 1 minute, 42 seconds to go. Wayne Gretzky trying to worm his way in deep and then pivots off and rolls for Krushelnicki. His shot is deflected away by Mars. Paul Coffey takes over with 90 seconds to go. Pass connects with Gretzky. Lays it in deep. That's the main Edmonton concern right now. Of course, the Flyers, with nothing to lose, will undoubtedly pull their goalie in the last 60 seconds or close to that. Hextall takes a look at the clock, then at the bench. Is not coming yet. Turning with it is Coffey. Plays it back on to Marty McSorley. Moves up with Wayne Gretzky waiting. The drop is to Gretzky. Gretzky yanks it back off to Charlie Huddy. His drive answered by Hextall. Shot 43 for the Edmonton Oilers. The final minute of play. The puck hops to Huddy. Tapped back though. And Dave Hunter rolls it back in for Gretzky. Forced off by McCrimmon. Mellenby can't take over. Still reaching but can't. And Gretzky drops it in again. Hextall turns it. Lowe keeps it. Forces them deep. The last four cups have been presented in Alberta province. Last year in Calgary to the Montreal Canadiens. The 2 years previously here to the Oilers. And with 39 seconds to go, the third could come in just a moment. You felt that being at the bench.
What a series. The Flyers knew they had a mountain that I guess was about the size of Mount Everest, and there were all kinds of analogies made. Rick Tocchet was approached on the subject of climbing the mountain, and he said, you know, we have a lot of mountain climbers. They went out to win game five. They went out to win game six. They won them both. But as we pointed out, Mike, in one of our earlier casts, there are a lot more people that have failed climbing Mount Everest than have succeeded. What a gallant try. Down to 39 seconds, two-goal lead, barring a miracle. Edmonton Oilers have won the Stanley Cup. There's Wayne Gretzky's dad. Shaking hands, trying to get a picture. So I want to get a picture of all of this. Mike Keenan, who has never said die, kept his positive attitude together even when his team was down.
Well, that is a club that is bloodied yet unbowed. They look at it as 39 seconds to go. Two goals they have to force overtime.
Yeah. You know, you can say what you want about winning, and it might not be everything, but until you play your next game, you know, it really simplifies all of your problems and makes the whole world look beautiful. And when you lose in a situation like this, well, very often it just makes you cry.
The next game for these two teams in the regular season isn't for 20 weeks.
A gallant effort by the Flyers. We have been so fortunate to be a part of this playoff year. It's been wonderful.
It gives you a tingly sort of feeling to watch all this, because really the fans are standing to salute their team, but also we feel they're probably saluting the Philadelphia team that courageously forced them to a seventh game and a chance to watch this. Hextall nearly handcuffed stick handling in the final 15 seconds. Playing it is Kevin Lowe. You want to hear the chant? Here it comes from 10 seconds.
Yeah.
come. Some of it in the form of exhilaration. Some of it not quite as exhilarating in the Philadelphia Flyers locker room. The big question for all of these athletes when they get up in the morning is such a strange feeling tomorrow morning. What do we do now? We don't have to go to the rink. It takes about 48 hours to become oriented again to what's really going on in life. You're so tuned out to what's happening all around the world. All there's been is the Stanley Cup to all of these guys. Hear in the background the song "You're Still the One" by a group Orleans, which has become the theme song of the Oilers. They're still hot in this town.
Why do the pictures say so much about mutual respect?
There are no words that the Edmonton Oilers can use right now to pay Ron Hextall enough respect. Some of them will try. Them shaking their heads, saying you were unbelievable.
Ken Nielsen may very well have played his last NHL game here tonight. That could be the case for Ruotsalainen. We know it will be for Pozar, who did not dress. John A. Ziegler, Jr., the president of the National Hockey League, is waiting to make the presentation.
Here it comes. The cup is on its way. Now maybe Marc Messier will talk to us. Here comes Al Weissman of NHL Security carrying the Stanley Cup, and it won't take long for the Oilers to get that out of his hands.
As heavy as it looks, Bill.
It's never heavy when you've won, Mike, when you get a chance to touch it. And it'll be in the locker room, and we'll see it after. It'll be full of champagne. It's not as heavy as it looks, but it could weigh 1,000 pounds, and these guys would find a way to carry it. Really doesn't matter now. Wayne Gretzky's still trying to organize things. Ever the captain, ever the leader. This is a moment that the players want to enjoy so much, and they're very tolerant of the fact that our cameras are down there, everybody's cameras are down there, but it's a moment that's very cherished by the players. They don't really appreciate being crowded that much. They want to be able to hoist it, get loose, and as a team, skate around and perform one of the greatest traditions in sports, and here it goes. They'll take turns with it. Here's Muni. It started with Steve Smith. Charlie Huddy's got his hand up. There's Huddy. Let the defenseman do it first. We talked about the Oilers having learned a whole new skill. That's playing defense. Glenn Anderson has it now.
It's interesting. Charlie Huddy went one whole month without playing a game twice during this season, but he got in for the big ones. Greg Muni was dealt to two different teams in a week and came back to Edmonton. The Philadelphia Flyers. And Marc Messier, who courageously came back after being struck in the ankle by a shot and made a lot of offensive thrusts and some hard checks and perhaps inspired the insurance goal by Glenn Anderson. For the record, Anderson from Huddy at 17:36 brought the crowd to its feet to stay. This bunch does not want to hear what they call the D word, dynasty. They've won the cup for three of the last 4